We will defend these police officers.
Listen to police officers' commands, listen to what we tell you, and just stop. The nation needs to realize that when we tell you to do something, do it. And if you're wrong, you're wrong. If you're right, then the courts will figure it out.
We don't get to take it. We enforce it. And at the end of the day, each and every man can go home safe. Sometimes the use of force is necessary. You need to comply with the police officer the way the system was meant to be. Comply with the orders of police officers. Resisting arrest is a real
Nonpartisan Liberty for All, and I'm your host Dave Bourne, and it is Tuesday, April 21st, 2015, and I'm coming to you live from Las Vegas, Nevada. Tonight we have an interesting show for you. We'll be talking all about the military operations that are going on in July, between July and September, called Jade Helm. So we'll be talking about that. There's also a story related to some closings of Walmart, and there were some, I don't know what they would call them, but whether it's, I guess, YouTube videos or people talking about, I guess they call them rumors, I guess, of some connection between Walmart and Jade Helm. And I have no idea what that fucking connection is, but we'll talk a little about the Walmart story as well. So thank you for tuning in to Nonpartisan Liberty for All. Check us out at nonpartisanlibertyforall.com. We're on weeknights, 7 o'clock Pacific, 10 o'clock Eastern, and promote the ideas of true freedom and liberty, meaning having the freedom to do what you want as long as you respect the freedom of others and allow them to be free. Also exposing government for what it is, a mafia gang that rules without consent by threat of force. Tomorrow we'll be talking about the show. Well, not really getting into the show, but I guess the idea kind of came from the show Orange is the New Black, but we'll be talking, which is a show all about women in jail, but we'll be talking about the jail being really the new punishment for almost everybody, or at least a suspended sentence. So we'll be talking all about that tomorrow. Mark Edge of Free Talk Live will be joining us in the first hour. So it's great to have Mark back on the show. And our voiceover girl, Katie Reyes, will also be joining us later on in the show to talk about that also. But as it is Tuesday, as we do every Tuesday, we have co-host Pete Murtha joining us live from Orlando. Thanks, Pete, as always, for joining us.
Dave, it's a pleasure to be back, and I'm looking forward to this show. It's an interesting topic, and I'm excited to talk about it.
Yeah, and I don't know how much, you know, being in the military but not really dealing with a lot of combat or anything like that, or being in the military during any wars, I don't know how much personal experience you can provide regarding something like this, but, you know, you may be able to give some kind of insight as far as the thinking or why they would do something like this in the first place. So before we get to the discussion, and again, I wanted to talk about we'll talk a little about the Walmart stories first. And then I have it's about a 15-minute clip. And what it is a someone from the military, I would call it, that's in propaganda, but they are speaking at a city council meeting for about 15 minutes, or at least what we have of the video, and they're talking about the Jade Helm operation. So just to clarify, this is not something that it's a conspiracy theory. It's happening. The military has admitted that it's going on and some of the details. So the way I kind of want to look at this is we'll play that clip as well as another clip that I have later in the show from another person from the military talking about it. And look at it from kind of two standpoints, because I want to look at it from basically just what they're saying, because I think that's bad enough if you really look at what the military has put out there. And then we can talk about all of these stories or speculation or things that people think it's really for, or what's behind it. And of course, everybody has their documents that say this or say that. But I think it's more looking at certain things and then coming to conclusions. So we'll talk a little about that as well. But I think just the what the military has put out there in general is really bad enough when it comes down to it, because it's just I don't really understand the purpose or the point, you know, they regardless of what they say it's for. So I would definitely, in my opinion, say that it's not for what they say it is, you know, at the very least. Now, specifically what the point or purpose is, I mean, that's open to speculation and you'll get a lot of it. So we'll talk, as I mentioned, a little about that. But I don't believe it's for what they say it is. But one of, I guess, the things that have come out by all these people that are putting videos out online is some connection between Walmart and Jade Helm. And I guess what one of the reasons were, and I don't see anything, and I'm not aware of even what the connection is there, but there are five Walmart stores that have recently been closed, and they say that it is due to replacing the plumbing. Now, there's a bit, I guess, of a quote-unquote conspiracy regarding this, not the relation to Jade Helm, but the idea that they're doing this on purpose because the people at these stores have been causing Walmart problems and trying to start a union and all of this stuff. So the claim is that by Walmart closing these five stores, they're able to lay these people off. One of the things that had mentioned, and this must be recent because it said that federal law, you get 2 months worth of severance if you get laid off. And I had never heard that. And I was laid off in 2010. At the time, I actually got, I think, 6 weeks of severance, but that was a company policy. And that's still not 2 months, obviously, but their policy was that they give 6 months worth of severance. But I had never heard, and I got a retention bonus and all this stuff as well, because it was something that was planned. So I actually made out pretty well, but it was not something that was mandated by the government. That's what they are. I guess it's potentially, I guess it could be, but they gave more for people that were there longer. And from what I understood, that was based on what they wanted to give. But I had never heard of something that you are given 2 months based on federal law. No, nor do I agree with that, that that should be mandated. I think it's great if a company gives a couple months worth of severance. But I think forcing companies to give 2 months worth seems kind of excessive there. But I'll have to look at that in more detail. But I guess there was some suit filed against Walmart as well. The United Food and Commercial Workers Union filed an injunction with the Labor Board or National Labor Relations Board to stop them from losing their jobs. And P, I don't know if you are familiar with this. I think the majority of stores are in California, at least some of them are. And again, the allegation is that Walmart is, they're closing these stores for 6 months. And just to clarify, I'm not a fan of Walmart at all. I try to avoid shopping there because they get all these benefits from the government that give them an advantage over all these other companies. They try to, I think, purposefully put out local businesses and mom and pop shops, which I think when it comes to department stores don't even exist anymore, because they get this unfair advantage by getting benefits from the government. And they are able, I think, to get to where they're at. Now, I'm not saying they would be non-existent if it wasn't for the government. Obviously, I'm sure there are some people that started Walmart that put a lot of hard work into it. But to get to where it is now and how they dominate, I don't think there's any way they could have done that without the amount of benefits they get from the government, whether it's tax breaks. And a lot of it is. And personally, I don't think any businesses should have to pay taxes or extortion. But if somebody does and you don't, obviously that gives you a huge benefit. If every city that you come to, you don't have to pay any taxes for 2 years, or it's the biggest place in that community where, you know, they're able to say, hey, well, we're going to bring in all these jobs. So you guys got to give us, you know, this amount of benefits here and there. And obviously the playing field is not level anymore. You have a business that's paying all these taxes and paying for all these things that Walmart is not paying for. But it's hard to believe that a store, I guess it's possible, but that a store would close five locations for 6 months, I guess, just because they feel that some people were giving them trouble by protesting and trying to start a union.
Well, I found one article that lists the locations, Dave, and there's two parts to your question, I guess. One is, you know, where these were. And I did find an article that claims to know where they are. One is here in Florida. It looks like Tampa area or St. Pete. And another location is by Los Angeles.
Yeah, I know there's one in Porco Rivera, California. And I don't know if it's that important exactly where they are, but I had heard of the one in Tampa, I think, as well. But I know, yeah, one of them was closed in California. I think that's in the L.A. area. But their premise, I guess, is that they closed them because of people protesting and these issues they had with the employees. Because I guess what they're able to do if they close them is lay the people off, even though I assume they would reopen in 6 months. So I don't know why, if they wanted to come back, they would rehire. I mean, I don't know why you'd want to come back after 6 months anyway. Why wouldn't you want to get another job within that time period, unless they just can't find one? I don't know.
Well, I mean, if their intention is to flush the employees, then, you know, that's a good time period to do it. They can't operate on higher wages. And you talked about them getting, you know, benefits from the government. They get heavy, heavy subsidies from the government. And it's not just in tax breaks. And I don't know their tax, anything about their tax history. But the two ways that they get a lot of money is, one is that many, like a high percentage of their employees, I think it's up to 40% of them, but it might not be that high, is they are paid so low that they're eligible for food stamps.
Yeah, but I don't know how I look at that as a break from the government, because I guess anybody could do that. Any business could pay people. I don't know how you do that. I mean, I think
because they'd have to pay ridiculous higher wages.
But yeah, but I mean, any business could do that, though.
Well, they don't, not like Walmart.
Right, because what I'm saying is it doesn't give them a benefit that other businesses don't have, because any business could say, well, we're not going to pay them that much money.
No, it's just by it's by percentage of it. You know, they have far more employees.
Right, right. That's true.
Benefits.
Right, right. Because they're a bigger store. But prior to that.
But it's big margin.
Well, yeah. Well, prior to that, though, into building up to having that many employees, you know, I think a lot
Keep
of it
employees.
Was them getting, you know, they come to a new town or a new city and they get these huge tax breaks. But yeah, I mean, that makes a difference because they do have a huge amount of employees. But again, at the same time, and I'm not condoning that neither, but I'm just saying at the same time, other companies could do the same thing. It's just, yeah, because they have so many employees, it's a huge difference there in the amount of money that they're saving. But it's technically not something that another business can't do.
Well, they don't. So, and the other half of it is that they receive more money in food stamps from customers than anyone else by a big margin also.
But again, that's still something that other companies can do. So,
if you pulled out the program, right, Walmart could not operate the way it does because it's such a big piece of their business. You know, when 40 to 60%, over 40% of their clientele are paying with government subsidized money, period. They wouldn't have those sales. They would have lower sales, a lot lower. So they're a huge, you know, and it's a subtle argument, but it's a true real argument. And it doesn't seem obvious. It's not like the government writes them a check they give people checks, and you know, it's just the way things land.
Obviously, they're getting money. They're getting a lot of their money because of government or from government, I guess, in that case, because it's going from people to them. But again, at the same time, it doesn't give them an advantage that other companies don't have. Other people could go and do the same thing at other businesses as well. Now, I mean, it's kind of hard to, when you really look at that, because, yeah, I mean, obviously at some point, I mean, at what point also, especially with the amount of food stamps going up in the past 4 or 5 years, I mean, Walmart has been as big as it is for a while now. So I'd be curious to see the percentage of that throughout, you know, the past 10 years or something, that how, or maybe even longer, to see, you know, what it was, say, 10, 15 years ago. Was it 20 or 30%? But, I mean, yeah, that's definitely a good point, that they are getting the majority of their money directly or indirectly from government, and they benefit highly. So they're definitely where you would probably see some corporations against things like food stamps and stuff like that, or welfare, or they're definitely for it because it benefits them. So you can say, though, that maybe they've been a big influence in increasing these programs, and they've been possibly lobbying for them as well, as they know that if they're getting a huge percentage of their business that way, that I'm sure that they're very well aware of that, and that may factor in to how they lobby or buying politicians to vote a certain way in order to keep that going and maintain that.
Yeah, it's they really need it. And the other point I liked you brought up was about, you know, busting unions. I mean, Walmart is pretty famous for keeping unions out of things. And one of the things that happens with unions is they tie their wage structure. This is what happened with the auto companies. The entire wage structure is based on the minimum wage. And when you do a minimum wage increase, automatically through these union contracts, everybody gets an increase, and it gets bigger as it goes up the ladder. So they definitely cannot afford to have that kind of a plan in their store system, because, you know, they're working on lower margins than other places through their volume. So, you know, I could easily see, I mean, when they lay out a story like they're closing the buildings for plumbing, you know, that's kind of weak. I don't see how plumbing, you know, Walmart would really go ballistic if a simple plumbing issue is, you know, holding up a store for 6 months.
Well, so you think that they're doing it on purpose to just get rid of these employees, closing the 5 stores for 6 months? And I don't know what the amount of money is that they'll end up losing. Of course, they're a huge company, and they're making money off of all these stores. But on the other side of it, I mean, would they say, okay, we're going to close 5 stores for 6 months and go all through that just to get rid of the employees at these stores? I mean, maybe they would. I don't know. Is it a lot of money to them? Maybe it's not in the big scheme of things. And it probably isn't. And, you know, when you look at all their stores and all the revenue that they generate, I would think in the big scheme of things, yeah, it's probably not a lot of money. But would they go through that for, and it does, I guess, sound kind of strange that 5 stores have serious plumbing issues. But yeah. I mean, would they, is it that important to them that they get rid of these specific employees? Why not just come up with a reason? Well, I guess it's probably hard for them to fire them at this point, because it would maybe obvious that what they're firing them for. But are they causing them that many problems that they want to close these stores just to get rid of them? Because that, from what I understand, is the allegation, that there's certain employees that they want to get rid of. I don't know how many as a whole that it is, but there are a certain amount of employees. And I try to avoid Walmart because I don't support them. And I rarely shop there. I occasionally I'll, you know, go there if it's something that they're the only place, I guess, that have them. But I hate going there at the same time. The type of store that it is, and the crazy people that I guess are attracted to Walmart. And if there was a department store, and you won't even see these anymore, maybe somewhere has them, but local stores that are owned locally, I would go and shop there even if it's a little more money. Unfortunately, there are none.
Yeah, they're great at crushing it. I have relatives in a small town that has been lobbying for over 5 years to get a Walmart in there. And it really, the area really doesn't support a store that size. But it will crush all the little hardware stores that are there. It will crush the supermarket that's there. It'll crush the liquor stores, you know, that are there. They don't sell liquor, but they do sell beer. And, you know, do you remember the Hostess story when the Twinkie was going to be stopped from production? I'm pretty sure, and your listeners could look into this more themselves because it's an interesting story. And it's one of these stories that has a long span. But I'm pretty sure Walmart was buying Hostess. And as part of Hostess closing, all their employees were getting laid off. So what better long-term plan than to pick up Hostess when you can make Twinkies overseas now or wherever for not being under the burden of, you know, the former union contracts. So well worth it to arrange a deal where you buy a company that's just closing its doors. Hostess wasn't losing money. They just closed their doors. And Walmart, I'm pretty sure it's Walmart who picked them up.
And, no, it's not. Somebody else did, because I remember when that happened. I don't know if they... unless something else, the company who bought them sold them after that. But I remember the company that had bought them, because their CEO is the Bumblebee Tuna guy, who was a lot younger. He was, you know, I think now he's in his late 20s or early 30s, but he was 19 and he was one of the youngest, you know, millionaires or something. It was his father's company or something, but he was an executive in it, and I think he was just known for partying with celebrities or something like that on his private jet. But from what I recall, and I could be wrong, I thought that whatever company he was with at the time, because they might have even sold the tuna company, had purchased it. But I'm not sure. But for a while they were going to totally go out of, they went, I think, out of business for a little while. And that was going to be the end of them. Yeah, because people had said, well, this is the last, you know, box of Twinkies you'll be able to get or any of this stuff. And yeah, they ended up coming back and someone, you know, came and bought them. But maybe Walmart was looking into it, but I don't believe they have it. But of course, they could have, if another company had purchased them, they could have bought it after the fact. So I don't know.
Yeah, it's you have to kind of follow these things for a while, because you never, you know, it's not directly how things pass sometimes, you know. And I'm recalling it from about a year ago or more when that happened. And but corporations and companies closing places to bust unions isn't a new story, you know. It's happened before, and it's a way of dealing with them. And because you could be a very valuable company if you don't have that burden. So, you know, if you can pass off the company assets to somebody else for a nice purchase price, you know, you're happy, they're happy, and they get an operation that's cheaper to run.
Well, so, the thing with Walmart is fucked up, because obviously I feel that a business should be able to do whatever they want. If they want to fire people or hire people, that they should be able to do that, that the government shouldn't be stepping in and telling them who to hire. However, Walmart wouldn't exist in the first place if it wasn't for the government anyway. So, and that's where I think things would work each other out, because as you were saying, if this huge percentage of their revenue is coming from the government, essentially, if tomorrow you said, okay, you can do whatever you want, but there's no more government and they're not going to give you any money neither, what happens? I mean, they fall apart probably either way.
It would, you know, they would have to raise prices, right? And then they wouldn't be Walmart anymore.
Right. Well, then all the other companies could compete with them. And that would be the whole thing right there. And that's a perfect example of, you look at the government interference and the regulations, and right away it's, well, you can't do that because, you know, corporations would just do whatever they want. Yeah, but it wouldn't matter because they wouldn't be making the money that they're making, and they would have to do something about it to continue to exist, whether, like you said, whether it's prices or whatever. So that would allow other companies to actually be able to compete with them. But one of the other reasons that they're not is because they're so huge that they're able to buy in bulk also. So, but they got that huge because of a lot of these benefits that they ended up getting.
Yeah. Yeah. And they, you know, they're a Wall Street machine. I mean, well, they're not private owned anymore, are they? Or did the Walmarts?
I honestly don't know. I know, yeah, they were owned by that Walton family, and I don't know if they're just majority shareholders at this point or not. I honestly don't know enough about it. I would think that they are, you know, a public company that could, again, just have the majority of the stock be owned by them, but I don't know. I don't know a lot about them. I mean, I did see this documentary, and obviously it was skewed in an anti-Walmart direction, but a lot of it was, you know, what I looked at before. And for the most part, from what I saw, you know, it is true. Of course, they take all the extreme examples, but I look at it again. I mean, if Walmart's doing that, if people just didn't shop there, of course, it's hard because they are able to dominate the industry. And for a lot of people, there's nowhere else to go because they put everybody else out of business. So, I mean, that's where, like I said, I mean, if there was no government intervention there, then that would kind of destroy Walmart. But it's hard because, you know, I think in some places where, again, I mean, there's probably not a lot of jobs, not a lot of options. Because I would say, you know, normally that if you don't like it there and they treat people badly, if everyone said, hey, we're not going to work here, then by the market itself, I mean, they wouldn't be able to do that anymore. Because obviously if they can't get employees, then they will have to pay more money. But when you have the government interfering in everything and destroying the economy and the currency and all of these things, I think there is something to be said about people not being able to get jobs in the way that they were able to, and to be able to support. I mean, you could look at years ago where people were able to support their family on one income and not even, you know, just graduate high school and get a trade or something like that, or manufacturing, which is non-existent at this point. So there's all of these things that contribute to it. But I think at the top level, it's government, and it's the government regulations and the government, in a sense, bailing them out or subsidizing them, along with giving them incentives to go different places. So I think that's really what Walmart is. And you take the government out of it, I think that's really the end of Walmart at that point.
They would be really hard pressed to survive the way they do. And, you know, their locations kind of show you how they operate. I mean, they're not always present in poor areas, but near where I live, there are people who live in a lot of apartment complexes, and there is no other place for them to shop. It would overwhelm the other stores around if they didn't exist. I mean, that's for sure. There'd be a giant change in the way things operate around here.
Yeah, even I don't see Kmart anymore. There is a Target, so that's still around. But from what I understood, they just closed a bunch of stores. So you used to have a lot of department stores, not so much recently, maybe now like 20 years ago. But even the smaller chains seem to have gone out of business as well. And then the other thing that Walmart did that is regional when it comes to everything else, the grocery part that they had added there. And grocery stores are regional for the most part. You don't have any national grocery stores that I'm aware of. But Walmart is essentially now also a national grocery store. So I stay away from Walmart when it comes to that now too. Before I had bought, you know, just some stuff there, but I don't give a fuck what their prices are. For the most part, I try to just avoid them altogether. And when I do buy something there, I kind of feel bad that I ended up buying it there in the first place.
Yeah, I agree. I've talked about it with my wife, and I said it's not good to give them money. And there are private grocery chains around that I'd rather do that with. And to be honest, the only thing I buy there really is ammunition, because it is the cheapest ammunition.
I get most of mine online, because online it's even cheaper. And I go and I'll even calculate, you know, the dollar per round and compare. And, you know, it depends too, not to get into too much detail on this, but, you know, if you're buying target rounds, it really doesn't matter what the fuck you buy. I mean, really, who cares? I guess if you're like a competition shooter or something, it may matter to you. But to me, and I would think people like me, that it doesn't matter for target shooting what the fuck you're using. I don't know about you, but that's kind of how I view it. But when you're looking at hollow points and self-defense rounds, that there are things to look at, like velocity and feet per second and things like that. Well, I guess for target shooting is more important when it comes to that. I don't know. It depends what the type of bullet, I guess, you're buying. I want to say, yeah, I need that self-defense to hit people from far away. No, that's not what I mean. But I mean,
right.
What I'm saying,
you
though,
don't
is
a lot of those either, you know.
No, but like even up close, like if you have someone that breaks into your house and you're, you know, up close, you want something that obviously is faster. If it only has 2 feet or 3 or 4 feet to speed up, you know, you want something that's powerful. You don't want something where someone's going to break into your house and you're going to shoot them and they're just going to get right back up. So to me, that matters when it comes to that. And I do look at those things, but online I can find the cheapest. Walmart isn't bad. I saw some of their prices, and it depends on the caliber also, but it's the same with that. I was looking at some a few weeks ago and I almost bought it there, but the fucking person never actually came. So I was like, fuck it. And one of the stores, they actually took my license number, and just out of principle, I'm like, I'm not going to buy. And this is a couple years ago. They were, yeah, when I bought, I think it was 9mm or something a few years ago when I had bought it, they actually wrote down my license number as well. I can understand, I guess, wanting the license, although I'm sure they're pretty, you know, it's pretty obvious I'm over 18 or over 21. So I don't know why they'd really need to verify that. I guess possibly I could, you know, it's not like I don't look like you or anything that old, but I guess potentially,
yeah,
I could be 21. It's very unlikely, but you know, so I gave them the license, but then I noticed they had written down the license number. So there were some other, and I don't even want to say stories, because I don't know if it came from anything or anybody that reputable, but that in Walmart somehow involved in Jade Helm. And I guess, you know, anything is possible, but that's where I had actually found this. And I don't know if it has to do, if they're saying their store closings have something to do with it, or, I mean, and we'll get into this in more detail later. There are businesses and private people that are giving their property to the government, or letting them use their property for the exercises. So I guess potentially anything's possible, but they made it almost sound like, you know, Walmart is part of this big conspiracy or something.
I saw one quote in an article about that, and it just said that since Walmart is such a big food supplier, that they can influence how, you know, what people have available for food. So if you went into a martial law situation, as the articles were suggesting, if you controlled food, you would get a lot of cooperation from people, because they just don't want to, you know, be hungry.
Yeah, but so, there's plenty of other places that have food. I don't know that they're
right.
You know, again, they are, as I mentioned, almost like a national supermarket in a sense now. But still, I don't know that there to the extent where, I mean, I don't know. I mean, I guess it's possible. And I don't know how food, you know, even food production and food distribution, I would assume that that's possibly regional as well. So I don't, are regional as well. So I don't know if you're talking about suppliers that are in, or distributors that are in each region. So you couldn't even dominate that across the whole country. And I don't know. But again, I mean, anything is possible. So I want to go to this clip that I have of a man from the military who's speaking at a city council meeting and is talking all about Jade Helm. Because as I had mentioned, a lot of the information that they're just giving out is scary in itself. So I'm going to play this clip. Then when we come back, we will talk all about it. If you'd like to call in with your thoughts, you can call in at 702-470-7664. Again, that's 702-470-7664. Or you can Skype into the show, username Nonpartisan Liberty for All. Just send a contact request and we'll ask what you want to talk about. So you can do that as well. Check us out if you haven't yet at nonpartisanlibertyforall.com. I just got my new, I guess, cards in that have all of the show information. They're like, you know, business cards, but they just have all of the show information on them. So I'm happy that I got those, and hopefully I will get to get some of those out over the next week or so. So if anybody wants to distribute some cards for me, please let me know if you want to support the show. So again, we will play this clip from a representative from the military, and we'll be right back after this. Nonpartisan Liberty for All.
I bring you greetings from Fort Bragg, North Carolina, United States Army Special Operations Command. I just want to be able to thank you all for allowing me to speak tonight to the City Council of Big Spring. This is an honor for us to be here to address you and give you some information on the exercise that we'll be conducting this summer in Howard County. My name's Tom Mead. I'm a retired Special Forces Senior Noncommissioned Officer. I spent 20 years in the Army and spent 13 with Special Operations. I'm currently a contractor working for United States Army Special Operations Command as an operations planner and an exercise designer for the Jade Helm project. With me this evening, I have Master Sergeant Tim Robinson. He's an active duty Green Beret with 3rd Special Forces Group out of Fort Bragg. Tim's helping us design this exercise to get it going, make sure it goes in the right direction. So my purpose here this evening is we are seeking written invitation and approval from local officials to conduct the realistic military training exercise within the jurisdiction of the city of Big Spring. Through the process, we're required, as what I'm here tonight, is to receive to ask for a letter of invitation from local officials inviting us into your community to allow us to train our soldiers for the next fight that they could encounter. We're not training for Afghanistan and Iraq, the things that we've done in the last 15 years. We're looking forward, and we want to make sure that these guys are trained properly. This is where we need the help of the local communities. We coordinate with all the local, state, and federal law enforcement. We've already been and we've coordinated with the police chief here in Big Spring. We've coordinated with Sheriff Parker already. We have coordinated up at DPS at the state level already. So everybody from a law enforcement aspect understands what the exercise is, and we want to make sure that we are completely plugged in with them to make sure they understand what's going on. The land use agreements that we do with the local public, we don't just come in to somebody's property and we won't trespass on somebody's property without the agreement of that landowner. The licensing agreement truly allows us, or it releases liability from the landowner. And we do a full risk assessment and medical plan. We've already linked in with the hospital. We understand how they get the life flight. We also have medical personnel that will be on site to assist should anything happen. What is Jade Helm? Jade Helm is a challenging 8-week exercise. Truly, in this area, in the Martin and Howard County area, we're only going to be here for about 5 to 5.5 weeks. The 8 weeks comes in where it's the preparation and the planning that happens back in Florida and in the Mississippi area. The exercise is a joint military and interagency activity. What this means is we have units from every military service participating in the exercise with us. And we also have some of our interagency partners, such as the FBI, the DEA, and some of the other agencies assisting us and working with us in the exercise. The exercise is going to be throughout seven states. Texas is the main bulk of the activity, I would tell you. And we are spread from east to west, north to south, throughout the state of Texas. It is a Special Operations Command General Votel sponsored exercise to improve Special Operations Forces' ability to conduct unconventional warfare as part of the national security. The exercise will occur from July to September. What we see here in Martin and Howard County is the guys will come in about August 7th or so, and they'll depart somewhere about September 10th or so. Who's participating? As you can see, it's all of our special operators. United States Army Special Forces Command, the Green Berets, Navy SEALs will be conducting operations over in Mississippi and Louisiana. The Air Force Special Operations Command will be flying specialty aircraft for us for infiltration and resupply of the operators on the ground. The Marine Special Operators will be working down in the San Antonio area. The 82nd Airborne Division will jump an entire battalion into Camp Bullis and take down targets inside Camp Bullis on a federal installation. The exercise locations in this area, we're working throughout Martin and Howard County. As some of you know, we briefed the Howard County Commissioner's Court yesterday morning. We received approval to operate within Howard County. Why did we choose Texas? Number one, United States Special Operations Command has been conducting exercises in Texas for a few years. We've done numerous exercises here. A lot of times you don't hear a lot about it unless someone like me comes to brief you about those exercises. And we know that Texans are historically supportive of our efforts to make sure that our soldiers, sailors, and airmen and Marines are ready to fight that next fight and train them for that next fight. What some of the things that we require is areas of undeveloped land with low population densities. United States Army Special Operations Command, being the director of the exercise, desires to have a very rural area for us to be able to operate in. Because the last few years, these guys have, in Afghanistan and Iraq, they receive aerial resupply by helicopter about once a week. They live in buildings. They have connectivity to the internet to be able to talk to their command, but also be able to talk to home. When they come out here to Martin and Howard County, they're not going to have those luxuries. In the scenario that we've built, they're going to have to operate outside of those normal support mechanisms and rely on the folks, the civilians that are in the area to be able to support them. We have a backside support element that actually will replicate that, but we also ask for, we can't do the exercise without the public's help. Things that we look for from that perspective is we look for people that are willing to be a role player, to just be someone who goes and gives a little nugget of information for them to build an intelligence picture to understand the scenario better and be able to operate better. We look for people that are willing to transport our guys because they have to move around in a clandestine manner. For example, in the back of a horse trailer in the middle of the night so nobody can see them. These are ways that they have to operate in foreign countries and when they're not supposed to be in those countries. We also look for landowners and business owners who would be willing to allow us to, on a landowner perspective, to be able to use their land, maybe live on their land, or to use a barn or an old barn to be able to conduct a meeting in the middle of the night for them to do planning with a higher command element. Shop owners to be able to use a back storeroom or a warehouse to do these types of meetings as well. They have to be. They operate in and around communities because that's the way we operate throughout the globe. Ordinary citizens are the first ones to notice something that's different, and that it causes them to have to be that much more careful. What can you expect? Now, understand that this slideshow is our standard slideshow that we use to brief the counties and the cities. Within the cities, you won't see most of this, I would tell you. For example, increased aircraft in the area at night. You'll see that out in the rural area. We have a resupply, an aerial drop that will occur, and then some paratroopers as well will jump into Martin County in early August. It won't happen within the city limits. But one of the most important things, and I know I've said it previously, is we link in with the law enforcement officers. They know when and where we're conducting activity. That way, we actually invite the police department to be near the activity. That way, they're able to answer constituent calls on that. The other thing that we do is we brief that prior to the activity going on. That way, the police chief can let the dispatch know that this is occurring, so that when they field phone calls from concerned citizens, they're able to meet that off at, or cut that off at the pass. But that's not normally anything that's out of the ordinary in West Texas, from what I've seen, especially during hunting season. And they may be driving civilian vehicles throughout the area. So really, within the city limits, if you notice my guys, they're probably really doing something wrong. Clear marking of the participants. That for us, that's one of the big things. We make sure that all of our guys have some type of marking that they'll be all be wearing an armband with a marking that identifies them as part of the exercise. So if I and what I mean by that is, just as we do with the law enforcement, if there's activity occurring around an area, we will actually go out to doors and knock on doors, introduce ourselves, and let them know that there'll be activity happening between this time and this time.
Mr. Meade, how often do you do a operation like this? Is this done annually or?
Yes, sir. So the Jade Helm project is a new project that has come along from General Cleveland, from his staff at United States Army Special Operations Command. This exercise is planned to be conducted yearly. We conduct an exercise that's similar to this, and I say similar because the scope and the breadth of the exercise is nowhere comparable to what we do here. But they conduct that exercise six times a year in North Carolina. So, did I answer your question, sir?
Sure.
Yes, sir.
Just had a couple of questions, and you've already started talking to the landowners and
yes,
setting things up. I just have to ask, how does FBI and DEA work with the military on operations like this?
Well, generally speaking, sir, the FBI and DEA provide us liaison officers up at our command level, depending on how the scenario is written. One of the ways the FBI and DEA are working with us here is in Arizona, they will actually do some questioning for us at one of the airports in Arizona. In Arizona, they will actually do some questioning for us at one of the airports in Arizona.
Do y'all use any personnel from NATO, UN, or
no, sir,
DHS?
Not,
or?
Currently for Jade Helm, it is U.S. only. That has been one of the discussions that I'm not sure if it has occurred yet, but that has been one of the discussions that I'm not sure if it has occurred yet, but not sure if it has occurred yet, but that I'm not sure if it has occurred yet, but
Name, please. About 3 minutes. We got a lot of speakers.
My name's Kimberly York, and I actually am one of the county residents. And I'm a little distressed with the fact, A, the county issued an invitation without letting the citizens know that it's going on in the county. I think that we should have been informed. I feel like it's being hidden from us about, you know, and then all of a sudden an invitation's issued and it's on us. And I'm a little bit concerned about that. I think as citizens we have the right. I also am a hospice nurse. I have a lot of concerns about our elderly population in this county and in this city by things that are going on and being distressed. It may double our phone calls for home health and hospices, because we will be the first persons you call, they call, and get distressed. You know, I mean, what the press is putting out is really different than what we're seeing here today. You know, the press is telling us, oh, you're not going to hear about it, you're not going to see it, you're, you know, it's just not going to affect your lives. Well, what we're reading here is that it might affect our lives. And I think as citizens of this county, we should have a voice in whether that invitation is issued. I've got some, like I said, some real concerns. There's safeties for civilians. Why are we looking at safety issues if there's nothing to see here right now? By the way, I am a military brat. I do support the military. I feel that there's other ways of training than inflicting it on the citizens of this county. Thank you.
Thank you.
You are listening to Nonpartisan Liberty for All Radio with your host, Dave Bourne. Call in at 702-470-7664 or Skype in, username Nonpartisan Liberty for All.
Nonpartisan Liberty for All. I hope everyone was able to listen to that clip, because that really kind of says it all there, I guess. Although, of course, I assume that they're leaving a lot of stuff out. But that is just an official from the military that was at a city council meeting that was explaining to them or giving an overview of what the operation was. And it's funny because at the end there, you had a woman who said that she was a military brat and she does support the military. I would say, in full disclosure, I do not support the military, period. And I mean that in the sense of, I don't think a military should exist. So I'll be clear on that. So you could say, I guess I do have a biased opinion, but not in the sense that I have anything against the military per se. I just don't think that in a country where people are able to be armed, that you should have a military, because I don't believe you have a need for one. Because if people attack the U.S., obviously you would have enough people to protect the land here. And really all the military seems to be for, and if you look throughout history, for the most part, and not, you know, obviously the Revolutionary War would not be what I would call a military. It was more of a militia of people that got together to fight here for freedom. I guess I would, you know, definitely call that for, you know, against a tyrannical government that was forcing themselves up on them. And then even in the, you know, wars that actually happened here, I would say that was more of a militia. But having a military, really, it gives the country the opportunity to go out and attack all these other countries and create their empire and enforce their will throughout the world. But I don't have anything against the military. And I do feel bad for all of these people, especially kids out of high school that are kind of lured in and end up finding out what it's really about. And by that time, you know, they're either emotionally or physically damaged, and they're not getting a lot of the things that get promised to them, that were promised to them as well. So, but in this Jade Helm operation, I guess I'll kind of explain it briefly and You know, we're here with co-host Pete Murtha, live from Orlando. I'm here live from Las Vegas. But Pete, please feel free to interject at all if you have anything to add. But I want to look at it, as I had mentioned earlier, kind of from two perspectives. I want to look at what information has been put out there by the government, what they're coming out and saying this is what it's about. Because, again, I think there's enough in that that is pretty scary. And then to kind of look at all these other things that are put out there. Some, I think, have some credibility, and some, I think, are just some people just putting stuff out there based on what they believe. And, you know, anything's possible, especially when you have a government that is doing all the things that they're doing. And a lot of them are consistent with things like martial law in the future, or taking more control over people. You have militarization of police and things like that. So a lot of these things they're pretty much doing anyway. So I think it does make sense that eventually that's where things would go. But that doesn't necessarily mean that this operation is for all of these other things. But I would say, if nothing else, there's more to it than what they're saying there is, because it doesn't seem to make sense. But I guess what Jade Helm, I guess officially it's called Jade Helm 15. And this is the first year, hence the 15. There was a woman who did a video who actually took it as an acronym and said that it meant, I can find it somewhere. She actually broke down the letters and said this is what it means. Now, whether it means that or not, I don't know, because especially the second part, the Helm part, sounded kind of just strange. But the Jade part, I would say, actually made some sense. I got to find it. I have it written down somewhere in my document here, but I just kind of have notes all over the place. So, oh, Justice Joint Assistance for Development and Execution is what she said. That just, you know, I mean, that doesn't really mean anything bad. You could join assistance for development and execution, you could say, of a military drill. But the Helm part was something that sounded a lot worse. And I thought I wrote that down somewhere as well, but I can't find it at the... Oh, Homeland Eradication of Local Militants. So, you know, you have the Joint Assistance for Development and Execution. Okay, that actually makes sense from any standpoint. But then you have the Homeland Eradication of Local Militants. And I don't know that they would name it that, even if that was their goal, because, you know, it sounds pretty bad.
They so always deny it.
Who knows? Well, true, but, you know, I don't even know that they put that out there, but who knows? Because, of course, they are denying it. They're denying, I guess, a lot of things. So, in summary, it's a military drill they're conducting over, I think now it's 9 states, although I had seen that Colorado somehow opted out on April 13th. I had seen a report on that.
That's awesome.
Whether that's true or not, I don't know. I recall it was from, I believe, a reputable site. So hopefully that is the case. And I would hope that other states would opt out, especially in Nevada, where I live. So you have mostly the Southwest, which is California, Arizona, New Mexico, Nevada, Utah. As I said, Colorado was supposedly, they have now opted out, so I guess we'll see. Texas being their main base of operations, and they have added Mississippi and Florida. In what we just listened to, they said something about Louisiana as well, which is kind of in between Florida and Mississippi. So I don't know if they're just kind of passing through there or what. So, but they were mentioned as well. So that would be 10, but then if you subtract Colorado, then I guess it would be 9. So what they're saying it's for, at least at a high level, and then we'll go into the detail, from the things that, not only that video, but there's another video that I had listened to as well, which is also from the military. And it's an operation, really, to train their people, the military, to train special forces. And the rationale they had given was, well, we need to train them on this terrain that's available in these places, and that's the rationale there.
It's that's a bunch of crap.
Well, it's to take place between July 15th and September 15th, although in one area they had mentioned the end date of September 11th, which makes it sound even worse. So it's 2 months of military drills, which is very strange.
Expensive.
From what I, among other things, from what I understand, though, this is the biggest military drill in the U.S. ever. I know they do drills all the time, but they're mostly in military. I mean, there's so many military bases, first of all. I don't know why all drills can't be done on military bases. I guess for whatever reason, occasionally they do them outside. He had mentioned something in North Carolina in the video, but I believe that was something for tests for Green Berets, and it's specifically within one state, and I don't think it's even all that big, and as he had mentioned as well. So this is huge when you're talking about all of these states, all of the departments of the military as well. And it, to me, it doesn't really make a lot of sense. So I'll go into some specifics of what the government is telling us that they mentioned both in that video and another video, as well as press releases and things like that. I found a press release on the Army's main site, but it really didn't say much. It was a couple paragraphs. So again, just to clarify, this is not something that is some kind of conspiracy theory that the government isn't saying that this is going on. This is going on according to the government, and it is training of the military and has a specific purpose. So first you have the departments involved, at least that the government is coming out and saying. All of them are special operations. So you have the Navy SEALs or Special Forces. I guess Special Forces conduct special operations. They did mention, special operations as well. So you have the Navy SEALs, the Green Berets, the Navy Special Ops and Air Force Special Ops as well. I guess they don't have their own cool name. They just have and I know the Marines was mentioned as well, but no specifics. You also have government agencies, the FBI and the DEA. And if you had heard the clip, they had mentioned that they'll be questioning people at airports. What that has to do with their whole training really doesn't make any sense, among other things that we'll get into. But that was a answer to a question that was from the city council meeting where I played
what they're doing at the airport is they're practicing interrogations right before they send them on their last trip to a concentration camp. So, it's kind of a good place to do it.
So, what they had, said was, and I don't believe they said it in this video, but in the other one, they said that this is all about unconventional warfare, that's what they're training for. And the explanation of unconventional warfare, they give a very basic one, was anything besides, that army over there is fighting this army over here and they're getting involved in combat. They compared it to something in World War II, what went on in Paris. I don't know all the specifics on that, but that was the, specifics given regarding what they're training for. So they're training for this unconventional warfare, and they had said that they need all these special terrains in all of these states. I don't know why you would need all the same terrain that is in similar states. So like, say, Nevada, Arizona, New Mexico, Utah, there's really not much of a difference in those states. I guess Nevada and Arizona, you have desert. You have desert in New Mexico, too. And you have desert in Utah. So I guess Southern California. So I don't know why you would need every single one of these states and not just need one or something like that. Sorry, go ahead.
Oh, no. I mean, did they really mention Paris as an example? Because what was happening there was the French were fighting back against the Nazis and they used guerrilla warfare.
Yes.
You know, tactics to stop an invasion force.
Yeah, and I'll play the other clip later on in the broadcast, but they mentioned what the U.S. did in France also. So that was when they had mentioned this unconventional warfare, that was given more as an example as to what unconventional warfare is. Because using that, I mean, it gives them this big whole thing of it could be anything.
It doesn't
under
mean
that.
Anything. It's so broad.
Right, exactly. It's a very broad term that could mean all of these different things, whether it's, you know, because that could get into stuff the CIA does with all these covert stuff and things like that. And,
yeah,
and so,
wars.
And I, you know, I think it's probably more that type of thing as part of it as well. And we'll get into some more of the specifics later on. But that's, I guess, at a high level, what this is about and what they're saying that they're doing. Now, the time that they had given was, well, most stuff will take place from 8 to 11 p.m. to 4 a.m. You may hear helicopters. You may hear noise. One of the things that I heard that was said was, they'll have weapons, but they'll be simulated paintball bullets, something similar to paintball. They were called like sim bullets or something like that. And they're communicating with local and law enforcement, so they're aware of everything that is going on. They're also using locals as role players. Now, exactly what they'll be doing is I have no idea. And on top of that, they'll be using people's property that they have licensed out for. So, and you had heard in the clip there, they had talked about using back rooms of businesses or barns or so all of these, this private property that they're supposedly contracting to use, whether they're, I would assume they're paying them, but who knows? And who's really going to say no? If the military comes and asks you to use your property, I think most people will be pretty intimidated and feel that they have to do it. So they're using that also. So again, I mean, when you're looking at all of this stuff and just what they're saying. Now, again, all of this is just what the military themselves are saying that is going on. It seems pretty scary to me because a lot of this stuff, what is the purpose? I mean, first of all, I don't see a purpose in one, conducting training in all of these states and the rationale for that. One of the things that was said was that they haven't been, it was kind of said rather strange, but like the Green Berets, they haven't been doing a lot of training recently in this type of scenario. So they need to kind of retrain their assets or something along those lines.
That doesn't make
so
any sense.
It's what are they going to be used for? What is the purpose of this? So right away, people would think or they would say they didn't really come out and say this is what it's for. But, oh, they're going to go fight ISIS in the Middle East. Right. That really, if you're looking at it and you're assuming that this is what they say it is and it's really for that, which doesn't make any sense neither, because why would you have, they had mentioned them communicating with people and for also if they need things, getting them from the public, which was strange. So instead of going through like the military, that they were to work with the public at large to get what they needed. It was rather non-specific and strange as well. So I guess you could say, well, that's if they're a undercover, or I don't know what you call it, undercover, but a covert person running a special operation in one of the countries in the Middle East, that they would have to go out and find resources that they wouldn't be communicating.
Well, yeah. I mean, basically scavenge or use people for information, questioning them. Like you said, transportation, you know, you got to practice seizing people's equipment when you're going to, you know, if you want to do it right. That's pretty creepy. I mean, this is a real escalation. That's one thing you can say, because they're even saying it. They've never done it before. They called it 15. So either it's, you know, that means something else, or it's just,
well, no,
year.
The 15 means this year, because they had also said that this is going to be every year they're going to conduct this training now.
Right.
So I don't know if it's going to be in the same states, or they're looking at doing this training every year within different states, but this is going to be a yearly training. So the 15 is, you know, for Jade Helm 15, and next year I'm sure will be Jade Helm 16.
And that's a pretty common thing. I mean, when they do operations, they do repeat them. That's normal. Doing them here off the bases, inside of communities, I mean, is not. And we can talk about this later, but they've been doing things in Florida already that are aggressive. So, but it's not part of this operation. But it wasn't announced like this one was.
Well, that I know it may be one of the reasons why they announced this, and I don't know what the timeline was, and as far as when they announced it, as opposed to when people were talking about it. But I don't know if stuff was leaked and they felt that they had to release it, or that people are going to see these things going on and they want to make sure that people aren't speculating as to what it is. And, oh, well, this is part of this whole Jade Helm operation. And one of the things that was said, of course, is that, well, they're going to do things under the cover of Jade Helm. They're going to, you know, fly in helicopters and abduct people and things like that. And we'll talk about that a little later. But that's, you know, some of the things that are being put out there in relation to this. But again, I don't really think you even need to look at what they're using it for to be concerned. We will talk about that. But just looking at all of the facts of this, who's not concerned that you have the military supposedly conducting special operations with special forces in a variety of states within the U.S., and that they're conducting these also with different people that are going to be role players, and using property from or private property from people? And that the DEA and FBI are also involved in this, and they're going to be questioning people at the airport, is one of the few things that they actually admitted that the DEA and the FBI are going to be doing. And you also have law enforcement as part of this, where they're being communicated with all of these things that are going on. So I would say that the majority of this in itself is reason for concern.
And don't leave out the real possibility that they're going to use foreign troops in this exercise, because that's getting bounced around. And, you know, what it would make sense for is for foreign troops to do this exercise, because they need to get familiar with working with the U.S. military in here and the locals. So that makes sense. And that may be the thing they try to hide most. You know, when they bring something out in public, all right, they're usually trying to provide a smokescreen for something else. And when they do something like this and they're admitting it, there's probably something in, they're being very honest and out front and open. Okay. But what they're going to hide, they're going to deny like mad, or try to deflect, you know, or show little interest in answering. So that's the one I really look for, because to me, that would make sense. Is to bring foreign troops in here, make sure they know where the bases are, you know, what how things operate in America, because it's different than other countries, and what to expect from locals, you know, how to learn how to intimidate them or address them or avoid them. You know, that would be very important. So for me, that could be the real, you know, hidden gem in there. But you'll have to see, and it could take, you know, a while for that to happen. It may not be this exercise, but maybe it's 17, 18, or 19 where it really kicks in.
Well, that was actually asked about UN troops, and they had said that it was kind of a weird thing, because he had said that we had met and discussed it, but we didn't meet yet. It was weird, and they had actually repeated
all three answers, right?
Well, no, he had said that no, they're not going to be involved and we had addressed that, but we didn't meet about it yet or something like that. It was just kind of strange, the answer there. But
no and maybe. Stammering through.
Well, he did know because he did come out and say, no, they're not going to be. But we really haven't discussed that yet, something along those lines. But, yeah, he had actually said no,
he did say no.
Initially.
Right.
But
and that's the tell.
You know, again, whether it's going to involve foreign troops or because he actually did say no, it's just U.S. But I think it's irrelevant because, again, when you're looking at this, let's even say that what they're saying it's for, that it's just training for them, is what it really is. So you have the whole idea of why would they be training, conducting all of this type of training? And, you know, whether they have a specific reason or not, which they kind of do, but not really, you know, for foreign stuff and whatever. But if they're conducting all of this training within the U.S. and the way they're doing it and all of the specific things that they're doing and only involving special forces and all of this, there must be a reason behind it to have that type of training, whether it's for the future in the next few years or now or whenever. If you now have the military conducting training in all of these states and using private property and using, you know, people as well to assist them, that's, to me, that's just a huge thing in itself. There shouldn't be this type of training like this. It's almost like confiscating areas of the U.S. by the military. And that, to me, again, in itself, is something that I don't feel should be going on. If they want to conduct some training, they have enough military bases and land at those military bases within not only the United States, but all of these other countries as well. So what training can they not do there that they feel that they have to do this? Not only that, is they know most likely that, you know, they're releasing this publicly because they probably believe that people will find out. So they're taking not a risk, but they're doing something that they'd probably rather do in secret and coming out and having to talk about it. And for them to do that, there must be a good reason or something important that they're trying to do and do this training there. Pete, your thoughts on that?
Oh, yeah. Well, this is really important to him. This is very expensive. This is a large operation. You know, the Navy does do very large operations because when you send out fleets to sea – and, you know, send them across the ocean for 4 to 6 months. That's really expensive. And they have done, like, things like that for a long time on a yearly basis. But I've never heard of something like this. And they even saying it's new. And they're going to continue it now. So I don't like – the thing with special forces is this. Special forces is an infiltration operation. Okay. And they infiltrate the local communities of a foreign country, embed with them and get them in a, you know, the big thing about that is that's where
they're going to be in bed with a bunch of people. They're going to break into their house and crawl in the bed. And you wake up with a green beret. I guess some women might be happy if they wake up next to a green beret, but the majority of us would not.
No. For sure. I wouldn't. So, but they also start the psych warfare. Okay. That's a big part of their operations, is to get that going. And so when, you know, if they were saying grunts were going to go through and march 20 miles and get in trucks and leave or bivouac for a week. Okay. That's still, they shouldn't be doing that off the base. And the bases are plenty big to do that on. We can talk about that, but they've expanded this. You know how they downsize bases? Well, they've also expanded these mega bases to make them as large as towns or bigger. So this special force effort that they're doing is weird, and that they're partnering with the FBI and Homeland Security. or
the DEA, which is the DEA itself is very weird, because the DEA, of course, being again, you know, as you said, the Drug Enforcement Agency, which in my opinion shouldn't even exist. Why would they be partnering with the DEA? That makes no sense whatsoever. I guess if it was the CIA and they mentioned the FBI and even DHS, I guess that would make sense. Probably DHS, you'd think right away that's for here. So maybe that's why they're not doing that. But the DEA, to me, makes no sense whatsoever.
Yeah, that just sounds like a cover for something else. I mean, it really does, because, I mean, yeah, what would they have to do in a military operation except, you know, they do have guns. I'll give them that. But they're not military, you know, absolutely not military. And, you know, the way to control a military is to have a bureau sit on top of it that is, minding the commanders. And, you know, so if they're going to report up to civilian federal authorities, all right, that are not military, that's beyond creepy, actually. You know, now they say it's a cooperation, but if it's a cooperation or a monitoring, I don't know. But, you know, classically, they don't need the FBI to operate. So maybe it's just this, you know, club of guys watching each other, making sure the other one doesn't, you know, get out of hand. So they, you know, they want definitely to, I could see why the FBI would be interested in being involved in this for sure, but it's creepy.
So I want to go ahead.
Well, they would just say that the FBI is there to hand off, you know, interrogation duties and arresting duties, because, you know, they're police force.
Well, they have already let the local police know, and they're supposed to be patrolling or covering outside of, you know, anything that's outside of the military bases. So they've been notified as well. But I want to play this other clip that I have and then continue the conversation regarding what they are, the information that they are releasing. And then later we'll get into all of the different speculation and things that people are saying this could be a cover for. Again, if you'd like to call in and join the conversation, you can call in at 702-470-7664, 702-470-664, or you can Skype into the show, username Nonpartisan Liberty for All, and send a contact request. You can also, if you're not listening to the show on the website, you can always go to nonpartisanlibertyforall.com/livestream and live stream the show directly from there, as well as Spreaker, which if you're not listening to it on the website, you're probably listening to it on Spreaker. But either way, check us out at nonpartisanlibertyforall.com, and we will be right back after this. So be sure to listen to this clip, because I think it's very important as well as very disturbing. So we'll be right back.
Bragg, North Carolina, and Lieutenant General Charles. Lieutenant General Charles Cleveland, Commander of United States Army Special Operations Command at Fort Bragg. My name's Tom Mead. I'm a retired 20-year veteran of United States Army Special Forces, also known as the Green Berets. With me today, I have J.R. Okendo, who spent 23 years in special operations. We actually served together in Afghanistan together. We have the distinct privilege of being able to give back to the force still. Today, we're here to discuss an exercise, and the purpose for us being here today is we're seeking written invitation and approval from local officials to be able to conduct a realistic military training exercise within Brazos County. The exercise will take place between July and September of this year. Just to explain what realistic military training is. The bottom line is realistic military training is any training that's conducted off of a military installation, such as Fort Hood or Fort Bliss. What it does, U.S. SOCOM Special Operations Command in Tampa, Florida, commanded by General Votel, has put a process in place for us to ensure that we're doing the proper coordination between the Department of Defense and the local governments that we're going to be there, and that they know that we're conducting activities in their backyard. Within the process, one of the biggest things is obviously the letter of invitation from local officials, from the county commissioners. Also, we coordinate very closely with all of our law enforcement folks. We've already met with the state DPS. Yesterday, I had the privilege of meeting with the sheriff and the chief deputy and explaining the exercise in thorough depth with them. So they are aware of the exercise that's going on. And then also we do a licensing agreement with everything that we do. So if we're on private property, we do a licensing agreement with those that allows us to use those property in that fashion. Within Brazos County, the activities that will occur will all occur at the Teeks facility and the Riverside campus. That's what we have currently planned for Brazos County. So in the big scope of the thing, this is one pinpoint or two small pinpoints in a larger exercise. The exercise is actually an 8-week exercise taking place across 7 states. As you can see up there, it spans the whole southwest of the United States. We've also added Mississippi, and we have a group also working out of Florida. What it's going to do for us, it's a SOCOM-sponsored exercise with Special Forces actually executing it and Army Special Operations bringing it all together. And it, what it's going to do is going to provide, in a bigger scope of thing, it's going to provide the capability to conduct unconventional warfare across the globe. To put unconventional warfare into a perspective, you see it a couple different places up there, unconventional warfare, and I'll explain that from a historical perspective. So conventional warfare is troops on troops, tanks on tanks, uniform enemy against uniform enemy is the way conventional warfare is generally defined. Unconventional warfare, from a historical perspective, if you think of World War II, Germany came in and they took over France. The French did not want them there. They formed the French Underground. The French Underground conducted activities such as subversion and sabotage. They would hit logistics lines to demoralize the Germans. So what a lot of folks don't know is there were American advisors with the French Underground throughout World War II assisting them in planning and conducting those types of activities. Since 1952, United States Army Special Forces has had the charter to conduct unconventional warfare throughout the globe. The last 15 years, we have been in Afghanistan and Iraq. We've been doing more of a counterinsurgency role rather than being able to enable an insurgency across the globe. So therefore, what we're doing is we're bringing these guys back and we're dusting off the skills that they already have, because every Green Beret learns unconventional warfare when he leaves the qualification course. He knows it inside and out. A lot of these guys haven't practiced it in the last few years. So we're bringing those skills back to the forefront for them. The activities that are going to occur in Brazos County will occur between August 15th and August 21st. The actual length of the exercise goes from about July 15th until September 11th. We'll end on September 11th and head back to home station. Who's going to be participating in this? Here in this area in Brazos County, we'll have Army Green Berets. Army Green Berets will be doing those pinpoint operations out there at Teeks and Riverside. We'll have Navy SEALs who will be conducting targets and training down in the Mississippi area. The Air Force Special Operations will be flying specialized missions for us. The Marine Special Operators will be jumping into Camp Bullis doing reconnaissance in preparation to receive the 82nd Airborne Division on a large-scale airfield seizure on Camp Bullis itself. As you can see from the exercise locations within Texas itself, we are covering a very large area, all the way from Caddo Lake all the way out to Sierra Blanca. and as far north as Big Spring and as far south as Goliad. So we're kind of filling the whole state, but those are very small pinpoint things. In each one of those locations, there'll be no more than about 60 folks that will be there in those locations. Here, particularly in Brazos County, as I said before, they'll be at Riverside and they'll be at the Teeks Fire Field. Why did we choose Texas?
Number one,
we've done exercises within Texas. We've been doing them here in Texas for years. One of the things that we have always found about coming to Texas, and I know JR and I, if you count all the mileage that he and I have done, we've probably traveled back and forth across the state of Texas probably about 10 times already since July of last year. But we have not ran into anyone who is not willing to help us out, because they understand, Texans understand, that we're training these guys to go out and be able to prepare our airmen, soldiers, and sailors to be able to go out and do the business of the United States military across the globe. And we appreciate that Texans are very supportive of everything. The exercise is going to hone their advanced skills. That's going to cause them to interact with other agencies that they don't normally interact with. And then we need large areas of undeveloped property from the bigger perspective of the exercise to be able to practice some of the things that they'll have to do overseas, such as operating outside the normal support mechanisms. In the scenario that we have built, they cannot get the normal once a week resupply of food or resupply of water. They're going to have to work with locals, which are role players that we have, local folks that have agreed to help us out as a role player or hire role players to be able to obtain some of the things that they need throughout the exercise. What can you expect in Brazos County? There'll be increased aircraft at night. We'll be bringing in some helicopters over on the Teeks facility in Riverside. We'll also be bringing in a fixed-wing aircraft, a C-130, into Easterwood. So with that being said, there may be some noise complaints that come along with that. All the activities out there will occur between about 11 p.m. and about 4 a.m. The personnel that'll be out there, they will have weapons, but they'll have simunitions, so military version of the paintballs. And then we will coordinate directly with the law enforcement, and the sheriff will be privy to everything that we're doing out there. And we actually invite the law enforcement, if they choose to have officers out there on station or in the area, to be able to respond to constituent reports, or as well as the dispatcher being notified to be able to field some of those calls as well. Safety. The first thing, our number one priority at United States Army Special Operations Command is safety, not only for our exercise participants, but also for the civilians. So some of the things that we do along with that is the communication with the law enforcement. We have medics that are assigned to each unit that will be moving with them. They each have at least two, and plus we will also have an additional senior medical personnel who will be on the ground to be able to immediately respond. We'll coordinate with the life flight and the local medical facilities to understand what they have available at their facilities should we have a mishap. We'll have an exercise support team. And then one of the big things as well that we've done throughout North Carolina, because North Carolina, we've been running an exercise that is similar but different from this exercise. And I say that from the respect that the exercise is only a two-week exercise in North Carolina. It's run six times per year. That exercise is the final exam for a Green Beret before he is qualified as a Green Beret. The R exercise obviously is 8 weeks long. Everybody who will be participating out here will be a fully qualified Special Forces soldier, Navy SEAL, or Marine Special Operator. What they've done in North Carolina is our public affairs office is very involved. They do newspaper ads, and they also run radio spots to announce that the exercise is going to occur. So that's where we'll engage the public affairs officer to get that messaging out. So one of the things that we'll need to identify is the local radio stations to be able to put that ad on there that exercise is going to happen during these dates. At this time, if there's any questions or concerns, I can field some of those. But I tell everybody, I know the commissioners have the packet that I provided. The most important page that y'all – excuse me. How do I go back?
You can do right-click, and then it should have previews.
Yeah. I hit it once. Got a little happy. That's the most important page that I can give you right there. That has myself and mine and JR's contact information, also our government project lead and the public affairs officer's contact information. If you have any further questions, you come up with something, an additional questions, please contact us. Public affairs should be able to answer just about all of your questions.
What would be the number of actual participants you have here during that time?
For Teets and Riverside, it's a special mission. Nobody will be living here. They'll be coming in from basically Louisiana, flying in here with helicopters and doing surgical strikes on particular specific apparatuses at the Teets location where they have the rail train, and also on the Riverside there next to the airfield, they have a warehouse there. So basically, no one will be staying in Brazos County. They'll be coming in, doing the hit, and extracting. Time on ground would be maybe 15 to 20 minutes of exposure. Then that's it.
Can we recommend some places to you to hit?
You know, every county that we have briefed has done that for us also.
Or maybe places our people.
Yeah. I think the biggest impact would be noise from helicopters coming in. But like I said, it's going to be a span of no more than 30 minutes. And that's why we put it over towards Eastwood and the Riverside, which is away from the population. So we shouldn't have anything out of the ordinary from that particular facility.
Now, we will have a support staff that comes in probably a few days prior to the activity to be able to make sure everything is laid on, everything is set for the exercise, and then they'll probably stay a couple days after the exercise to make sure everything was good, replace what we need to replace, and finish coordination. As Shannon said, that's a little bit of OPM coming into your county.
And you mentioned having volunteers, local.
Yes, ma'am. Those are in some of the other locations that we're going to be in. Not here at in Brazos County. The folks that we'll have here as the opposing force that will be on those targets are our military folks that we will have from a liability standpoint.
Promoting the ideas of true freedom and liberty, Nonpartisan Liberty for All Radio with Dave Bourne.
Nonpartisan Liberty for All, and we are back. So that was, and Pete seemed to think that was the same clip that I replayed it, but it was a different clip. I think that the speech may have been the same. It sounds like what they're doing is they have this presentation, I would think, that they put together, and they're just doing the same presentation. And in that one, there were a lot more specifics that I had noticed than the other one, where they got into who was doing what in this specific county and the operations that they were conducting, where in the other one, it followed the same – basic bullet points, but it didn't go into as much detail, I think, on some of the bullet points that they had there. But that one, and I actually even took notes when I went through that, because there were so many things on there that, again, is just disturbing and I think shouldn't be going on. And between the two, I think there's a lot of information in those that, again, is quite disturbing. And that's why I wanted to make sure I played them so everybody could hear those for themselves and realize that, again, this is the information that the military is giving out. And then we'll get to speculation here or there, although I don't have as much detail. I did go through a lot of stuff relating to who thinks what. I didn't go totally through, I guess, the Alex Jones theory where he gets all his documents and information. And he had said, I listened to some of it, but he had said he predicted this already and he already knew about it a while ago and whatever else he said. So I didn't go through all of that. I did go through some of it. And I'm sure, Pete, you looked at some stuff as well that you can also go into. But this in here, I guess some of the stuff that wasn't in the other one, and I had actually kind of mentioned a lot of it already as we were talking about it before the break. But the specific special forces involved, and I talked about that in this clip, he actually said in this Brazos County, I guess that's in Texas, and I'm not familiar with exactly where it is, but there's a bunch of cities and counties in Texas where they're conducting these operations. And I guess that's the biggest place or state, the main, well, of course, it's the biggest in area, so I would assume it's the biggest operational-wise, but where the most military is going to be and be conducting these. But he had said for this one, July 15th to September 11th, and then you just think of, well, the idea of could any of them be doing a false flag operation or run on September 11th? And somebody had brought that up, of course, as well, as had brought up what was going on at September 11th and conducting drills and things like that, where it's possible the same scenario could happen where they're actually conducting drills, so nobody does anything about it because they think it's part of the drill and it's actually something real. And I guess we'll go into some of those things a little later. But Pete, what did you really get from that? And again, just based on the information that is coming from the government, what are your concerns, even assuming that they're just doing what they say they're doing?
Well, my concern is that they're not actually they're not doing this for any reason that they want you to know about.
So even if this is for the reason of, as they said, well, we want to be able to operate, and I guess this is kind of a quote, operate in and around communities. Unconventional warfare across the globe. They want to be able to conduct unconventional warfare across the globe. So outside of the fact that they may be doing this for other reasons, which I obviously think they are as well, but even if they're not, what about just being able to conduct these within the U.S. on non-military bases and in all of these states and do all of the things that are part of these drills or training?
Well, it's horrible, right? I mean, you could take this. I'm not even going to address the side that says this is just a normal good precaution. We have spent so much money preventing terrorism.
You spent a lot of money on preventing terrorism?
I have.
You got those anti-terrorist windows and doors up at the house?
You know, I really can't even say your tax dollars pay for it, because it doesn't, right? I mean, when you pay your taxes, this isn't even starting to cover the bill on this. You know, they spend so much money on it, and you could go on and on about it.
But yeah, the military budget is like more than if you take like the top 10 or 9 military budgets in the world or something ridiculous like that. And that's just what we know about. I mean, then you have all the stuff where the money just disappears. Like in 2001, they had said that $3 billion or $3 trillion, I think, disappeared from the Pentagon. So that's probably where that money that's disappearing is going.
Let's not split hairs, right?
It was in the trillion.
That was Rumsfeld, said, was you know, multi-trillion dollar right. black hole.
That now, just disappeared, that they can't account for. So obviously, right. you know, some of this stuff is that's probably where it's going to all of these things that we're totally unaware of. Probably not even this stuff, probably to even more secretive type operations or programs or whatever they're conducting that we have no knowledge about.
Right. So, as you mentioned, well, I'll just stick with this topic we're doing right now. But, you know, I don't think they're going to divulge why they're really doing this. They've spent so much money between Homeland Security, the FBI, and the CIA, and the NSA, and who knows how many other departments we don't know about, saying they're protecting us. So they protected us so badly that now we have to buy into this, you know, test. And as the guy said, they're going to practice snatch and grab drills. Okay, why? Why does the military have to practice snatch and grab in our communities? And the reason is because they're going to do it. They don't practice for what they're not going to do. They've done this all over the world. They practice it on their bases for decades. And you know what? We're pretty good at it. You know, we don't need like new practice because we're phenomenal at this. What they want to do is practice.
I'm not. I don't do it. But you mean the U.S. military, U.S. government, the U.S. special ops people?
I like, you know, I know you like to go blackout at night and jump in helicopters and,
right.
you know, put the IR gear on. And
I'm good at it, right?
Because I don't even know you do it, you know.
There you go.
I'm that good at it. So this doesn't – I don't know how to stop saying we either. So I'm just going to keep saying it because it doesn't mean you and I. It's an editorial we. That means someone else does it. So they are doing this to practice doing it to us. And it's also psychological. They want us to relax about it. They don't want us to be uptight about the military running around in giant equipment, you know, stomping around. So they need to relax us because if they weren't upfront about this, it would be a huge conspiracy. But, you know, they're going to make you feel relaxed about it. You'll hear people talk about it at work if they ever bring it up. They'll be laughing about it.
I don't think it's gone that, you know, when they're going around talking about it. On the other side, I mean, I don't think you're going to hear news reports and government media about it. I don't think it's to that extent where, yeah, they're admitting that it's going on and providing some information when asked. But again, I don't think it's something. I mean, even on the U.S. Army website, there's one press release on it and that's it. So, yeah, I don't. Sure. I think they're just doing what they have to do. But I don't think you're going to hear about it on any government media.
We'll find out, right? I mean, it's one thing to, you know, announce that the fleet is coming in for, you know, the 4th of July in New York. This is a bit different. And the duration of this exercise is crazy.
Yeah, 2 months, it seems like it's going to give them a lot of time to do a lot of things. That's why, well, what are they up to? Why do they have to do a training exercise for 2 fucking months? And he had mentioned something in North Carolina that runs for 2 weeks, and that was the Green Beret training where they, I guess, supposedly do this same type of training, the unconventional warfare. So that's 2 weeks, and this is 2 months. And there's just no way in my mind that they could be doing this for just to go over and, I guess, conduct unconventional warfare throughout the globe, as they said. And I guess the globe includes the United States because that's all part of the globe.
Well, you know, it's about logistics. When you go that far out on an operation, what they say in the military is when a force lands, it has 2 weeks of supplies. That's what they go in with: food, fuel, ammo. They have 2 weeks that they can carry in and use. And after that, they have to be resupplied. So a 2 month exercise is doing that, you know, basically four times. So it's not for to replicate an initial landing force. It's to replicate an invading force that has taken up residence.
Yeah, so that's what I was going to say or ask you. So they are essentially going to drop them off, put them out there, and they kind of said this, that they'll need to get their own supplies.
They did.
So they're going to say, hey, here's your supplies. We're just putting you guys out here, and this is what you're going to do. But what the fuck are they going to do when they're out there for that time for 2 months doing what? And that's where, if they're conducting unconventional warfare, what are they going to do to be doing that? Obviously, they're going to be doing certain things, and that's where covert operations and stuff like that would factor into it. And possibly they are actually conducting those, but they're conducting them during that 2 months on wherever they are.
Yeah, they're going to figure out not only how to carry out their operations, you know, but how to sustain themselves, like you said, and he mentioned, you know, how to find water, what food sources are available, how much can you lean on the local population, you know, for supplies, because that's what occupying forces do. They turn to the locals, you know, to provide them support, either willingly or not willingly. I'm not saying that's going to be a direct result of this exercise.
Well,
cause
the U.S. is
that
occupied.
That would not be an exercise anymore.
The U.S. is occupied by forces. So.
Well, that's true. And that's not even you're not even being, drawn an analogy there. It's a
right. But what are they going to do? So they're dropped off. I guess they have certain things. But what are they going to do during that whole time that whatever they're supposed to do is going to take up all that time? And aren't they going to be doing things against the people, or at least collecting information or planning things or things that I guess what I'm getting at is doing things that they can use later, that it's not well, this is training us for when we go over here, that we're actually conducting an operation where we're planning surveillance or we're getting information or we're doing this or that, things that are going to be used later. So not just a operation of, you know, for training, that it's really like, okay, there's a specific operation against the people, and that's what they're actually going to be conducting when they go out there.
Well, they can build infrastructure too. You know, They practice building quick airfields all the time. You know, the engineers, they build an airfield and set it up as a temporary airfield. But if they're bringing in equipment like helicopters, they have to build airfields, and they're going to operate out of the airfields. They're going to practice doing that. And maybe they're going to dig and bury, you know, resource structures like storage for things like fuel or food. They may leave that behind and say, well, you know, we're just going to practice this, but, you know, Farmer Brown, you get to keep this cool fuel storage thing and have fun with it. But it's now going to be in the ground and available for later use.
Yeah, you know, I guess that's part of what I'm getting at is setting up things that can be used later. Again, whether it's, you know, some kind of infrastructure for landing planes or spying or whatever, that, you know, and that's a good point on the specifics there of, yeah, I mean, they could be setting stuff up so it will make it easier to invade an area. If they want to take over specific areas that they're going into, by setting some of these things up, exploring the territory, all of that stuff, that it will make it easier for them. So they could be, and this is kind of what the government is doing in general. We talked about before all the infrastructure that they're setting up regarding the whole spy grid. So they're setting up all these things, whether it's the surveillance grid or giving the police all of this, all of these tanks and automatic weapons or all of these things that they're doing really for preparing. And that this could just be another part of that. And I don't think that's any type of far-fetched explanation at all. Now, they can say that it's training and that they did all these things for the purpose of training, but it's there. It can serve a multiple purpose. And they could, you know, especially being that they're going to do it every year, you can look at, well, do they have a 5-year plan here where they're going to do one area at a time? And then later in the future, you know, maybe after 5 years, in the sixth year, that they're just going to totally take over a bunch of areas? Or is it where, okay, there's not a set time, it's when they decide to do it, but at least there's a lot of that infrastructure there?
Oh, yeah. I mean, that makes sense, because two months is a hell of a long time to keep your focus on a military operation. It's not easy to bivouac, even in the military.
What does that mean for people like me that don't know and other people listening?
You're setting up a camp, right? And you have to build things like latrines and water sources, and you have to build patterns of resupplying them. And it's because you're remote and it's not self-replenishing. Like, you have to find groundwater is ideal. You don't want to try to use a foreign source for water because it's expensive to bring it in. You'd rather just, pump it out of the ground. So they could be building wells, And when you bivouac, you just can't live in your own filth. You have to take care of garbage.
Is that like bushwhacking?
It's very similar, but not as much fun. Bushwhacking means ambushing, right?
I thought it meant actually whacking a girl in her private parts.
No, I've never been bushwhacking.
Yeah, I don't know. I think there was a wrestling tag team called the Bushwhackers. I don't know exactly.
Yeah, there was actually.
Back
in the 80s or something?
Late 80s, early 90s or something. So
I think it's just a redneck fun term. But it gets really complicated the longer out you stay. If you're staying for 2 weeks, you fly in, you do light supply and you leave. If you're staying there, that's a different story. And frankly, the guys that are on this operation, it's no fun to be abroad in an operation, because you can't go home.
It's no fun to be a girl in an operation abroad.
They come back pregnant a lot. So,
right.
Well,
yeah, I mean, this really sounds like, and we can get into also some of the other theories that are out there. And one, I have this clip from YouTube where you have this really religious guy. And it seems like there's a lot of it's intertwined there, that you have a lot of these people that are talking about end times and things like that, that are religious and then tie it to this stuff. And I know you talked about before that there seems to be a link between really religious people that are quote unquote anti-government, although they're not, anti-government in the way that I would call myself, anti-government or not believing in government. They just attribute it to, God comes before government, and that's really their big thing there, and that's why. And that's really the sole reason that, our rights come from Jesus, not government. And I would say they definitely don't come from government. They come from something else. I wouldn't say Jesus. I would say more just being a human or being born. But I guess you can look at it the same way. But I want to play later in the show, I'll play this YouTube clip of this guy who really sounds like a nut who's talking about Jade Helm. But we will get into some of these other things. But yeah, it seems like a CIA type thing. I mean, I've watched the show Homeland just to see, what bullshit they're putting out there. And it's almost kind of like the same thing where they dropped the CIA agent in Iraq or Afghanistan or one of these countries in the Middle East. I think they were more like in Pakistan, because some of those countries, I think, are maybe too dangerous for the regular CIA operatives. But they'll put them in there and then, they'll conduct whatever shit they're doing, whatever propaganda or covert operation or those things. And then, obviously they'll have to be on their own while they're there. And it sounds like a similar thing, like you were saying, you're dropping people off. Essentially, but using the U.S. as a place to do it. Again, I don't know why they couldn't do the same thing on a military base, especially as you're saying that they're so big as well. But I think they want to use all of the people and the resources, because there's another agenda there. as well. And remember also that it is special operations. Now, the DEA and the FBI being involved is very weird there, or sketchy as well. But, you know, who knows what their real goals are there in having them involved. But one of the, I think the biggest thing, and you probably came across this as well, that people are putting out there is the implementing martial law, that this is about implementing martial law, and that's why they're doing this drill. And I would say that maybe, as we just talked about, if they were, you know, setting up some kind of infrastructure there to do it in the future, that would make sense. But I don't think it makes sense, as that's a way that they would implement martial law. I mean, it doesn't really make a lot of a sense to me. I don't know. What are your thoughts on that? And did you come across, I guess, different theories or thoughts on people as far as what they wanted to, what they thought was going to happen, and the people that were actually talking about martial law and what information, if any, they had on how they're coming to that conclusion?
I saw a few articles on it, and it wasn't anything. I didn't think there's anything really solid there, because they're just speculating that a force is here and it can be used to clamp down and execute martial law. And you see some videos of tanks being moved on trains, which is okay.
Yeah, but why would you use special ops to do that also? Why would you use special ops to implement a martial law?
Yeah, see, that's the deal, right? This is a special forces-focused operation, and they're into, like I said, psych warfare, reconnaissance, okay? And they get in with a local community to understand them and infiltrate them. They're not an army that sits on top of you. So either they're lying about the special forces part. So, you know, if people are thinking that, you know, there's going to be foreign troops involved and they're going to be positioned in places out of sight from the locals, you know, while people are looking at the obvious exercises going on, the real loud show with special forces, if they're going to park a hidden army out of sight of people, which isn't really hard to do, you know, and it's hard to prove because you can't go near them, then, you know, maybe it is. But you'd have to get evidence of that would be really hard. I mean, you'd have to sneak up on a base with, you know, like 50,000, you know, troops and go, aha, you're not special forces. You guys are straight leg army or, you know, regular grunt Marines. And how are you going to prove that unless you can identify the units? And, you know, who says they're going to be wearing their unit insignias? So that's a real tough thing to prove out at this point, unless you found, you know, a smoking gun document and someone could release it. But I'm not saying it's not in the realm of possibility, but I don't think we're there yet. Like, as far as how bad things are gone. I mean, we don't have a currency collapse yet. You know,
yeah, and that potentially
all the junk food they want.
From what at least I guess our resident man on the economy and geopolitics, that it, by the end of the year, if not earlier, you know, after September, that's I guess what he's predicting, is that most likely will happen. You know, September, really October, I think, that the currency will collapse due to what China and these other nations are doing, creating their own World Bank, which they have done. I don't know when it's actually operational, I guess. And the SWIFT system, that it will, I guess, be operational in September. So that could be something that, again, is a reason for setting up infrastructure for possible things that could happen in the future. I came across something, an article that talked about Mexico, and it mentioned the tanks that you had just talked about going on a train, I guess coming, these ones were coming to El Paso, but that Mexico wants their old territory back, and that it has something to do with that. And there was talk of and I don't know where this actually came from and if it's even legitimate or not, that there was a comment supposedly that Russia said that since the U.S. had their military in Ukraine or was backing them, that Russia is going to back Mexico and taking over the U.S. or something like that. I think most of that, you know, sounds pretty out there and ridiculous, to be honest. But that was something, you know, an article about that as well, not from anywhere that I would consider reputable, but that it was. I mean, I guess it sounds interesting that, oh, you know, that's why it's the Southwest, because Mexico wants to take back those states that used to be part of Mexico. And, you know, they are getting backing from Russia. It actually talks about China as well. So being the, you know, kind of a link to Mexico and then China and Russia. And then there's the Jade comes from you have these other people doing YouTube videos that Jade means China, you know, has that. It's the reason why the Jade's there is because of the link to China. And it's about China taking over or something along those lines, where you have all that speculation of, well, China's going to take over or whatever bullshit that they put out there about that.
Yeah, so many stories that can distract people. So what I would venture to say is the real truth is never in the news, right? I mean, you'd have to deduce what's really happening.
Yeah, but I mean, these are people that are putting stuff out there. So it potentially somebody could do a YouTube video if they actually knew and put it out there. So what I'm saying is, it's not that these people don't necessarily believe this stuff, and it could be out there. I mean, in one YouTube video, there could actually be whatever the truth is, but who knows if that person, you know, all these people are speculating and who's actually telling the truth and who's not. You have people that are former military that are doing YouTube videos and saying, well, you know, based on my military knowledge, I think this is going to happen, or I think that is going to happen. So you have so much speculation. And really, I'd warn people, I mean, just as much as you get the stuff you get from government media, you get some of the shit, same type of thing. And I don't mean that's sponsored by government, but just that a lot of things, how can you believe it, from a lot of these kind of out there independent journalists. And a lot of independent journalists are reputable. And I, you know, that's really what I go to. But then you have some that are not. So you definitely have to be leery of them as well, that don't just, well, because somebody, you know, put something out there and they have a website and it looks nice, that means, you know, somehow that their information and articles, you can just trust it. And I wanted to ask you if you heard about this, because, and maybe I missed something here, but, and this kind of goes to the, you know, just believing, I guess, anything that somebody puts out there and shows some exaggeration here. But Alex Jones talked about that supposedly Hillary said to put people in camps, that she, I don't think he used the word FEMA, but essentially said that re-education camps, that Hillary said to put people in re-education camps. So he played the clip. Did you hear anything about the re-education camps? Do you know anything about that?
Well, they've been talking about that for a couple of years.
Right, right. I mean, essentially you have them already. They're called jails. And speaking of jails, tomorrow night we'll be talking all about them. And for the first hour, Mark Edge of Free Talk Live will be joining us. So be sure to tune in for that. But yeah, I mean, pretty much you have jails, you have all the punishments. I know somebody, and she's going to come on the show at some point, who had her son taken away by CPS and got him back. She has to take these parenting classes. And I told her I wanted some of the stuff that they give them, because I'm sure that the way they teach people is all the same type of indoctrination. We'll tell your kids to do this or to do that. Schools are also, you know, might as well be re-education camps as well, or just, you know, I guess it's not re, it's just education camps. Anyway, she had, from the clip that I heard, and maybe I can even play it, all I heard was her, she joked and said that older people should be in like fun camps or something, or camps to have fun. I didn't hear anything really about re-education camps, and Alex Jones is this big story that Hillary says to put people in re-education camps. And that's why I want to know if you had heard the clip as well, because I don't see it. And this is not always the case, because the majority of stuff from Alex Jones has been, at least what I have seen, you know, has I've never really found, for the most part, a lot any stuff. Well, maybe not any, but that comes out and that's not, you're not able to find other information on it that kind of validates it there. I have seen some exaggerations, though, and something similar to this in the past, with which it was ridiculous because it was exaggeration on a clip of what somebody said. And you can just watch the clip. And it was the Mike Adams, I guess, of Natural News. And he really exaggerated this whole thing, and it had to do with abortion, but it had to do with a clip of somebody else saying it. So I don't understand really exaggerating or kind of manipulating something like that, because people can just watch it anyway. Maybe they think no one's going to watch it. But I don't see in this clip where that is, where there's any mention of her saying to put people in re-education camps. Now, I'm not saying that maybe she doesn't think that. I'm just saying that I don't see it in this clip, and it sounded like they put out, you know, this is a big breaking news story that Hillary Clinton says to put people in re-education camps.
Well, he's run those articles before, but another source of it is that's close to her, but closer to the current president, is Bill Ayers. And Ayers is a big proponent of... And these are quotes from him. I'm paraphrasing, but they're really closer to quotes of having to wipe out like a third of the population if we can't re-educate them. He thinks he's for re-education camps to get people to believe in a new you know, society. And the Clintons aren't far away from him. The current president is closer to him, but. You know, I think Jones does some pieces, I wouldn't say many times, but, you know, you do see him where they really draw a far analogy or connection. They really kind of draw that thin.
Yeah, and that's what I think this was. And not to sorry, and I interrupt, and I don't want to get off topic, but let me play this briefly, because a lot of the stuff, of course, regarding all of these, all the speculation as to what Jade Helm is really about, you know, even if you search for it on YouTube, the majority of videos that you find are from him. So let me play at least this part of the clip of Hillary.
And then we will get Jennings.
Here it is in a second. There it is.
Older. I have decided we really need camps for adults. Where, you know, none of the serious stuff, none of the, you know, life challenge stuff, more fun. I think we have a huge fun deficit in America.
Notice they said fun deficit. Democrats especially want to be taken care of.
So that's, I don't know what you heard on there, Pete, but I didn't hear anything, that had anything to do. Oh yeah, I didn't turn it up for you, so sorry about that. And my whole point was to have you see it. Hear it. So I'm gonna play this clip again. I apologize for the people that did hear it, but let me play this clip again. I actually have to adjust. I have a mixed minus set up, and I won't get into detail on what that is on Skype for Pete. So if I don't turn up a certain thing, he can't hear it. So we'll play this one more time again. This is supposedly a headline of Alex Jones says, or Hillary Clinton calls for re-education camps. And here's the clip of it.
I have gotten older. I have decided we really need camps for adults. And we need the kind of camps that you all run. I mean, really. Where, you know, none of the serious stuff, none of the, life challenge stuff, more fun. I think we have a huge fun deficit in America.
So that's the clip again of Alex Jones saying that Hillary calls for re-education camps. So I assume you could hear it at that time, right?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. So, I mean, what did she say? Unless he's referring to something else, an article where she is quoted, but they went to the video, and I only heard this quick YouTube, you know, it's like a 4 minute, 4.5 minute YouTube video, but I don't hear anything in there that says that she calls for re-education camps. I mean, what was your, what are your thoughts on that, or what did you get out of that?
Well,
and not that I'm defending, I don't like Hillary, of course, you know, no, and I don't think she's a good person, but I'm just, you know, it is what it is.
You know, you'd have to be more from I'd have to hear more from the speech, because if that's the only soundbite, maybe someone asked her, how do we convince people?
Well, you know, but why wouldn't, if he's going to play a soundbite, that's supposed to be the soundbite that, that says it. Yeah, he's referencing it and brings the, and I'll send you the whole clip, but he's referencing it, and that's supposed to be the soundbite that's supposed to say that she said it. I didn't hear it. And again, I don't know if maybe I'm missing something and there was an article that said it, or there was a part in the speech, because all she said was bring back camps for older people and they should be fun. Like I actually, what I got from it was, you know, like the camp, you know, kids go to camp, and the whole camp for kids and saying, well, adults should go to camp and have fun. I mean, it was fucking stupid, but I don't get how that has anything to do with re-education camps and having a, I guess, title over it that says Hillary calls for re-education camps.
Well, there was two parts to that, right? At first, she said straight up, and Hillary does this from time to time. She kind of has to backtrack on what she says because it's too blunt, you know? And that's a chronic thing with her. She really doesn't try to protect what she kind of... She doesn't really have the art of what her husband had, you know? He said some things that were...
The art of being a philanderer?
Slick. She's not slick.
That's right. Yeah. She's not slick like Slick Willie.
That's right. You big can say that about Hillary lady all day. She has no slick anywhere in her persona.
The only slick she has is all over her vagina from me.
She's
I give her a nice coating.
Oh my God, I can't unhear
of that hanging vagina. It's pretty old.
Well, it's been through some wars, right? So she is not slick. So what I heard there was she
slick
said something
Willy
too blunt.
Isn't that what they called him? Something slick. Did they call him Slick Willie? Yeah, because he's Bill. Slick Willie. I was like, where'd he get Willie from? That's right, I'm Slick Willie.
Where'd he get Willie's from?
Oh, it really sounds like him. Well, he's Bill, right? So,
there you go.
Yeah, and I don't want to spend any more time on this, but...
I like talking about it. Hilarious.
Well, because I want to get back to really what we're talking about. But the only... The point being there is that there are... Or there's a lot of reports coming from Alex Jones, which I would expect that. And I like that they cover that stuff. But it's just, you know, sometimes between the arrogance and I knew this before, there was that, well, I had known this already anyway. And this is what it's for. And this is whatever. And I'm not saying that, you know, I actually appreciate some of the reporting that he does now. I hate the fact that he comes to this conclusion that you need to just go back to the Constitution and elect the right people, whether he believes it or not. That's what he promotes. And you know what? Most of the people that are putting this stuff out there of the speculation, that's what the conclusions that they come to as well. There's this whole saying, you know, restore the republic. You know, we got to restore the republic and go back to the Constitution. And so I don't really know how those people, you know, are that much better. I mean, I guess they are to an extent, but then the people on the other side, because really they want to maintain an environment that allowed this to happen in the first place. So they're saying,
well, they are,
let's go right back to this so this can happen again. And they just don't get it. So because we don't, well, I mean, we still got about 40 minutes left, but I want to make sure I play this YouTube clip of this religious freak that talks about Jade Helm because it's pretty disturbing.
Bring me there.
It's pretty disturbing, and I'll talk about why as well. But these are some of the people, you know, when they talk about, oh, we need armed revolution, and these are some of the people that actually would end up probably taking over. And that's what's scary, that the majority of people that want an armed revolution are more of, you know, these guys who want to take over and rule with, instead of Sharia law, they want, like, you know, Christian law, essentially, to rule. So I'm going to play this real quick. It's about 8 minutes. And when we come back, we will talk about this and more about Jade Helm. Of course, your thoughts are always welcome. You can Skype into the show. Username, Nonpartisan Liberty for All. Just send the contact request. Or you can call in by phone, 702-470-7664. Again, that's 702-470-7664. And we will be right back after this with co-host Pete Murtha coming to you live. Nonpartisan Liberty for All and nonpartisanlibertyforall.com.
YouTubers, Pastor Bob NCC. Yeah, I want to talk to you for just a minute about a military exercise that's going on right now. It's going to happen all across the entire Southwest, California, Arizona, New Mexico, Texas. I think they're even now including Louisiana, Florida. I mean, it's just, and what it is, it's completely unconstitutional. It's called Jade Helm. And the Constitution says that the United States military cannot police the citizens. Our military has no right to do anything on public land with the citizens. The National Guard was established so that if there was riots broke out or if any emergency, anything happened, the governor of a state could call out the National Guard. The governor controls them, and they can come in and restore order. The National Guard, not the military. The military is not allowed to do exercises with the public on public land. Totally against the Constitution. But as we know, this government, under Barack Obama, they've thrown away the Constitution. People, listen to me. The Constitution, over the last 8 years, it's all but non-existent. The government doesn't go by it anymore. So anyway, a lot of people are up in arms over this exercise. And Jade Helm, even the name, every name that a military puts on an operation has meaning. And Jade Helm, Jade, China, Helm, at the helm, who's in control? China's in control. Listen to me. You don't have to get all upset over this. And this is why. This is what it says in Isaiah 21:24. It says, how the faithful city has become a whore. She who was full of justice, righteousness lodged in her, but now murderers. Your silver has become dross. Your best wine is mixed with water. Your princes and rebels and companions, they're the companions of thieves. Everyone loves a bribe and runs after gifts. They do not bring justice to the fatherless, and the widow's cause does not come to them. Therefore, the Lord declares, the Lord of hosts, the mighty one of Israel, ah, I will get relief from my enemies and avenge myself upon my foes. And Isaiah 2:8 says, their land is full of idols. They bow down to the work of their hands, to what their own fingers have made. People, listen to me. That's talking about the government of any nation. It says the princes, the rulers, the ruling class. It says your princes and rebels are companions of thieves. Everyone loves a bribe and runs after gifts. That's talking about every single person in Washington. They're all on the take. They're all thieves. And then it's talking about the land as a whole. The land is completely full of murderers, and everyone is into idol worship. And idol worship in America is alive and well. We have rock stars, movie stars, American Idol, sports figures. Everybody in this country worships idols. So what happens? We thrown God out of our country. We've murdered 60 million babies. That's just flat out sacrificing unborn children to demons. That's what abortion is. America is under judgment. We are no longer a nation under God. Therefore, God has taken away his blessing and judgment has come. What do you think all these storms are? All these storms, the drought in California, the fires we go through every year, and the great massive earthquake that's coming. These are all judgments from God. People, America, the United States of America, is a cesspool. It is a cesspool of sin and filth. Open homosexuality that's now accepted by the government. Listen, this is why people, patriots, veterans like myself, are mad, especially people about my age. We grew up in a different America than what's here right now. Our Constitution is gone, and people want it back. People, listen, it's never coming back. America is done. It's done. And this exercise, like Jade Helm, just proves the government is doing whatever it wants, completely against the Constitution, because America's done. We're never going to be one nation under God again. Our Constitution's not coming back. It doesn't matter. And this is why. The Bible says there's a one world government coming. That's just the way it is. Nations come, nations go. And we are on the downside of America. Because we've rejected God, therefore God's judgments are coming. And you cannot fight this. This is a satanic world. Satan is in charge of all the kingdoms of this earth. He is the God of this earth. And everything written about in the Bible is going to happen. This one world government, it's going to come to pass. And pretty soon, something's going to happen, whether it be a false flag event, a natural disaster like Yellowstone, something's going to happen where they're going to declare martial law and our freedom will be gone and we will never have it back again. That's what this Jade Helm is all about. It's all about them practicing to impose martial law. That's what it's about. That is the whole underlying theme of the whole thing. There's going to be bloodshed. Don't think there's not. There's survivalists all over this nation. There's people banding together. We're a well-armed society. And civil war is coming. Everybody knows it. Civil war is coming. But people, the course of this nation has already been set. The only thing that could stop it, we're not going to stop it with guns. The only thing that's going to stop what's about to happen is if people repent and return to God. Push all the homosexuals back in the closets, quit murdering babies through abortion, clean up our cities, get rid of the drugs, get rid of everything. If this nation was to repent and turn to God again, God would make this nation great once again. But you know what? What's the chances of that? People, listen. We are one event away from martial law and your freedom being gone forever. America is going to get very, very ugly. We're going to wake up one day and we're going to be in a Mad Max syndrome. We're going to be living just like the days of the Terminator. People, you need to repent. You need to put your faith and trust in the Lord Jesus Christ because America is about to get very, very ugly and people are going to be dying. It's coming. The handwriting is on the wall. 9/11 was the last warning that God gave America. The last warning. And now judgment has come and it's going to be swift. People, it's the way it is. It's all talked about in the Bible. It's going to happen. We are dissolving and this one world government's coming. Listen, put your faith and trust in the Lord Jesus Christ. If you do that, he will see you through these dark days ahead and you will live on into eternity. If you don't, you're going to spend eternity in a lake of fire. That's the way it is. Choice is up to you. Get ready for troops on the street because they're coming. They're coming. I hate to be the bearer of bad news, but that's just the way it is. Listen, put your faith and trust in the Lord Jesus Christ. He's the only ticket off this planet. Take all the time you need to think about that. You have till the moment you take your last breath. Because once you do, it's a done deal.
You are listening to Nonpartisan Liberty for All Radio with your host, Dave Bourne.
Nonpartisan. My voice was a little like, congested there. Nonpartisan Liberty for All, nonpartisanlibertyforall.com. Check us out there. So that was some lunatic, some former Marine, actually. I think he said Marine. I'm not sure if he was a Marine, but he was a former military veteran. And, you know, this is some of the shit. Actually, you know, to be honest, not to this extent, but I do hear, like, Alex Jones and especially his fans talk about shit like that. And the first thing that really started to bother me about Alex Jones is his shit when he talks about abortion and all the killing all the babies. And this is a guy who was a former abortion clinic protester, like, before he got on the radio. So meaning that he kind of took his initial conservative agenda and then, you know, I guess some stuff, I don't know if he had changed his views, but kind of held on to that and then took it in a way to apply it to his views now. So meaning that, you know, that's part of the conspiracy through abortion to control population and stuff like that. I'm not saying that some of that actually isn't true in how people try to promote it, but if you have the actual government going around and kidnapping girls and aborting their babies, you know, talk to me when that happens. Otherwise, yes, I'm sure you could use that in a negative way, as people can use anything in a negative way. But the majority of girls who have abortions do it because they feel it's their only option, not because they're like, yeah, let's have an abortion and celebrate it and whatever. And the government told me to abort this, so I'm going to. But anyway, this guy, what's kind of, you know, you can look at this and it's just like, well, this is just one crazy guy. I mean, he had 16,000 views on YouTube. His channel is subscribed to by like 17,000 people. And this is some of the stuff, though, that kind of, in a way, goes hand in hand with what people would call the conspiracy theory people, although I'm sure people would call me that as well. I don't think I'm to the extent of a lot of people, but I do question things, and I believe that, you know, the government lies about everything else, so there's a lot of incentive for them to do a lot of these things, so I don't put anything past them. But to come out and say, well, if you don't repent and everyone doesn't take Jesus Christ into their heart, then, you know, the world's going to fall apart and martial law is going to happen. And that's why. That's basically, that was his point there, that everybody needs to go back to God, because it was great, you know, 50 years ago when gay people had to stay in the closet, as he had kind of mentioned about, you know, that's where gay people should be. And in a lot of places, black people didn't have any rights, and all of these things years ago were great, I guess. So he wants to go back to those times.
Yeah, well, he was just all over the place. I mean, his argument was infallible if you just listen to him. But it's crazy, man. I mean, we're going to have Yellowstone explode. I know all about the Yellowstone, you know, volcano. But we're either going to have martial law because of that, or we're going to have an earthquake, or we're just going to have martial law because, you know, and I don't even think he's aware of a currency collapse, of our own making.
And that, I mean, a lot of these things could actually happen, but not for the reasons that he's trying to give there. So, and that's what I kind of mentioned earlier, that you have a lot of these really very religious people that talk about freedom and liberty, even though most of them are more conservatives and they want to force their religion on people. But you do have a lot of them, and it's based on the fact that, well, Jesus is above government and really has nothing to do with having freedom. And that's kind of the serious issue there to me, is that it's not that they want people to be able to do what they want and that they believe in self-ownership. I don't think it has anything to do with believing that people have the right to do what they want because they own themselves, as long as they don't hurt anybody else. It's more just that, well, we do what God says. So if God says to oppress people, then that's fine. But the rights don't come from government. They come from God. So that's really what their rationale seems like. And as I had mentioned, I would think that in my opinion, the majority of the people that talk about armed revolution are people like this guy. Maybe not the majority, but, well, a majority meaning more than, you know, the biggest percentage. But, I mean, it could
be
pretty similar.
There's a lot of people talk about that.
But, yeah, I would say that those are the people that would take over, even the people that aren't as extreme as him. But I would even put Alex Jones kind of in that category, not to the extent that he is. But, I mean, he talks about a lot of that stuff as well. So especially the people, a lot of the people that listen, I know there's probably a lot of people like me, and I don't really listen as much anymore. And again, I still think I don't want to just sit here and bash Alex Jones. I think that there's a lot of positive things that he does, especially with police state stuff. But even talking about these things and really questioning them and talking about the, you know, what's really behind them and things like that. So that's fine. But again, you know, telling people, but just go back to the Constitution and elect the right people. But you do have an element of religion in his show. And he's not to the extent of this guy, but there are plenty of people that listen that are, and that those are the people that I'm just as worried about as, maybe not just as, but yeah, probably as the people that talk about, you know, wanting government to run their lives as well. Because all they would do is install a government where they control based on their ideas, you know, based on their religion and what they think right and wrong is and what freedom is.
Yeah, and, you know, guys, like, I have to, like, tone myself down about Christians and the angle this guy's coming from. You know, go with his argument about repenting. Okay, so you're sorry for your sins and you don't sin anymore. Do you think that's going to stop the New World Order from doing what they're doing? No, it makes you sit on your hands because you're focused on yourself.
Well, according to him, it is.
It's useless. It doesn't do anything. He's talking about coming out of it and being – he's really talking about being saved spiritually. But I'll tell all these Christians this. If you sit there and let evil people do evil things to everybody else, you're not going anywhere but that lake of fire. That's my prediction.
Well,
how the hell can you be saved if you just sit here and say, I'm only worried about myself. I don't care how many people we machine gun down, blow up.
The other thing he had said as well is that China, or at least as I don't know if he said it, but he had put in his video as a caption or at least in the notes there that China is in control. So saying that, I guess this comes from China or something. But I mean, looking at it as just one nut, I guess, is one thing. But when you have a lot of people that actually have this view, and going back to Jade Helm, looking at a lot of the videos and a lot of the opinions there, and that's how I actually found this, a lot of them had the same opinions. I'm not, I think, to the extent of this guy, but religion was in it. You find it a lot of the Jade Helm videos were on like religious channels where their channel was called like some kind of religious name on it. So you definitely have this religious thing. Some of it was the end times, which I think I mentioned earlier, that you have the world's going to end. And yeah, so, you know, all of this stuff is going to happen as well. And that, you know, Jade Helm is all part of this whole, well, the world is ending and we need to repent for our sins. And it's because God's taking out his wrath on the U.S., And all of that shit.
Yeah, that makes you look like a genius by saying it, doesn't it? And they're, you know, if you want to look at yourself and get closer to God, I'm all for that. But if you want to sit there and tell people how evil they are, when you're not doing a damn thing about the evil that's here, just go talk to yourself then, you know? Because you're really lying to yourself. You're not about the truth. You know, and you're not, like you said, you're not about freedom. You just, it's, this guy's, you know, getting off on this stuff.
Well, yeah. If you listen to this, and again, I just want to again reiterate that this is one, I think, extremist, I would say. But there are a lot of people that are very similar or have very similar views here. But, and I totally forgot what I was going to say there regarding this. But as for some of the other, I guess, ideas or things that people have put out there, and to talk a little about that, we had talked about martial law being one of them, and that doesn't really make sense. I know that's a common theme that people had put out there. I mentioned, you know, Mexico and something about, you know, Russia, and this had come out as well, saying that Russia wanted to arm Mexico to attack the United States because of what happened in the Ukraine. And even if they did, I don't think they're going to come out and actually say that anyway. So that's kind of ridiculous. But were there any other things that you had come across in what you had looked at?
Oh, about the whole martial law exercise?
Not yes. About martial law, but about anything in other people's theories, I guess, or speculation as to what this really was about.
Oh, the Jade Helm. Nothing that we didn't cover today. I mean, it's pretty light as far as analysis. The Washington Post had a piece. Did you read that one?
Yeah, I'd actually seen, you know, I had seen that as well, about the freaking out, the internet or something, that, that how it mentioned that, Jade Helm was freaking out people on the internet. Is that what you're talking about?
Right. So that was that's the lead piece. If you Google Jade Helm, that's the first.
Yeah. Well, that's
thing
more
that
the propaganda government media piece as
you're a freak if you're worried about
what they're.
Jeez,
yeah. And you know, again, I think as I mentioned, from just what they're coming out and telling people, I think this is something you should be concerned about, whether you believe their story or not, as to it's just training to go over to other countries or whatever. So I think even if that is true, I think there's still reason to be concerned when you have the military just kind of conducting training in all of these states. I would say commandeering, although they are supposedly asking for permission to use private property to have people being involved. But I mean, who's going to say no to the military? And I don't know how they go about asking people. But I mean, do they even really have to try to intimidate them? It is the military. It is the federal government. I'm sure people are scared to say no.
Well, it's intimidating, you know, when you there's nothing scarier than a big piece of armor rolling by. I mean, they're huge. You can't
well,
really
I'm sure there's
it.
Things that are scarier, but it would be scary. Well, that's what I'm saying. I don't know that they're rolling up to ask people with a tank. So, you know, when they're asking people to use their property for a few weeks or a couple months, I don't think they're rolling up in a tank. But I'm just saying the fact that you're from the federal government and you're asking to use something, I think that's intimidating in itself. Just like, you know, when a police officer asks you things and they're sitting there with a gun strap there with their little attitude and you know they're a police officer, I think that enough for many people is intimidation. If they're saying, oh, I'm going to search your car. And of course they say, I'm gonna, even though you could say, no, you're not. But they do it in a way where they try to intimidate somebody and get a answer out of them that they want to get, or just, you know, they don't stop them from doing it. So the government in general, if they're asking to, especially the federal government, you know, they're asking to use your property, I think most people are going to say yes, just out of fear alone.
They could. Do you remember, was it in Missouri when they did exercises last year and they said it was just the military showing the local police how to use the heavy military equipment they gave
them? I wasn't
aware
of that, but
what
had happened there?
And they did searches in that.
In Missouri? I should actually ask Thomas, our Thursday co-host. I'll ask him when he comes on Thursday. And every Thursday we do End the Government Police, 7 o'clock Pacific, with North Missouri Cop Locks, Thomas Woody. So he lives in Missouri, so he may be, I'm sure he's aware of what had happened there. But they're saying they went. Well, I mean, I'm sure he's aware of something like that is going on in his state. It is a really big state. And I'm not saying it actually directly affected him, but I'm sure he was aware of something like that going on. So you're saying like that they actually went house to house and searched people's houses for guns as a training?
Didn't hear about what they did, but they went house. I heard that they went house to house, and it wasn't what the news presented it as. That the news said it was just the military training the local police how to use the heavy equipment, the armor,
how to violate people's rights.
They heard that no, there were troops there going house to house.
Speaking of that, so that's and we only got about 15 minutes left, so I want to make sure I get to this. But that was one of the other major things that people had brought up. They had brought up one being gun confiscation, and the other, I guess, people confiscation. So actually going out, and I have noticed here in Las Vegas, and I've mentioned it numerous times, that I see helicopters everywhere. I see helicopters flying over my house. I see them way outside the strip because there's always a helicopter like watching the strip over the strip. And they do have helicopter tours, but they don't go over my house or all these other areas outside of the strip. So I've seen helicopters everywhere. So one of the things there, or one of the things that people were speculating about, was that they would get people used to seeing all this stuff and think it's a drill. And then under the cover of a training, they would go after people that were considered, dissidents or political, I don't know the word I'm looking for, but people that the government wanted to get rid of. I don't know necessarily kill them, but maybe put them in some kind of prison or re-education camp or something like that. So that was one of the things. And the other was to confiscate guns. There was a few reports, again, just from people on YouTube, but about it, because I heard it multiple times, about this labeling people the red and blue, and red were supposedly gun owners and they were going to be targeted, I guess, to take away their guns. And blue, I still wasn't clear on what that was. One lady said it was something about international troops that were placed in the country. I don't know how or what they'd be targeting them for, so that wasn't clear. But with the red, it was clear that they were going to do gun confiscation. So those are two of the other things that were being thrown around, that they were going to do gun confiscation and that they were going to get rid of people that are speaking out about the government and just kind of disappear them. So it was almost like what's happened in Captain America, if people have seen that, where that it was more an actual machine, from what I understand, that was going to go, and based on logic built within their systems, it was going to determine who was a threat and who could potentially be a threat in the future. And it calculated something like 20 million people in the U.S. and it was going to go out and kill all those people. So
giant gunship.
It's yeah. So
an aircraft carrier.
So it's basically similar to that, in that it would go and I guess get rid of political dissidents and people that are speaking out against the government. To be honest, I mean, I don't believe those things, as far as happening at some time, are that far-fetched. The government going after people, they've done it already. I mean, they've arrested people that have posted different things on Facebook. So they have done that. There are people that a lot of people that I would consider political prisoners. Bradley Manning is more of a stereotypical definition of a political prisoner. I don't know if that would, stereotypical, but meaning that he's directly a political prisoner. So there are people that I would say would be considered, indirectly, I guess, a political prisoner as well, where people might not think of them that way, but they would be. So there, that has happened and it is happening. And I could see that happening at some point, where people are just kind of rounded up that are speaking out against the government and put in re-education camps. I definitely think that that's possible. Again, they're doing it already. Now, just because they don't call something what it is and they call it something else, does that not mean that they're not doing it? And again, that's the case with these people that they're arresting for posting shit on Facebook or for rap lyrics or for various things. So again, that's not only something that is realistic, it's something that's happening. And then gun confiscation actually has been going on in California and I believe New York as well, where they have a team in California specifically, they have a team that goes around, and if you are no longer meet their criteria, so say when you purchased a gun you did, but you got arrested for something since then, or now you're in some database, or they changed the criteria to have a gun and now you don't meet it, they have gone out and gone to people's houses and confiscated, literally confiscated guns. So that is another thing that not only is something that I could see happening, is it has happened already. So do I think that this has anything to do with that? I would say that's unlikely. But I don't know. Pete, what are your thoughts on that?
Oh, you know, I think since this is the first time through, they like to do things so that you get used to them, right? They just incrementally move into your territory. So I think this is a familiarization drill.
Right. That's what they did with, they do now with the increase in militarized police. And they start with kids in school and they bring in the police and they have lockdowns all the time because miles away you have some incident that somebody's involved in where they barricade themselves in their house. Somehow they have to lock down the elementary schools that are 1 to 2 miles away. And that's a specific actual story that happened here in Las Vegas. So it's the same concept of getting people used to a police state or having militarized police around.
Well, yeah, like checkpoints, you know, DUIs or other just plain old checkpoints now are in the U.S. That's a fascist, you know, communist, you know, tyrant, you know, operation that's been going on in the country in select places where they just, you know, stop traffic and pull people over, you know, when they don't have the right to do it, you know. And, you know, they shot that woman to death in D.C. because of it, you know, because they freaked her out at a basic military-style checkpoint.
Yeah, it was a checkpoint somewhere in close to the White House. I mean, not that close, but within the,
it was in,
you know, a mile or something.
Mall, I guess. Yeah, and so this is another way of them introducing this to get you used to it. It's 2 months long. How long before it's 3 months, 5 months, permanent?
Right? Well, it's funny how they say initially that you won't see them or you won't know they're around and that they're doing it late. But then they say that, oh, well, the DEA will be at the airport questioning people, or that they need help from people and stuff like that. So
this is normal.
It's contradicting. This is totally normal. Yeah, I mean, it's contradicting a lot of their things or some of the things that they're saying. They're then contradicting. And, you know, obviously with these helicopters and stuff, if they're flying helicopters at 2 a.m, I'm sure that people are going to hear them. They did mention that, like, oh, the biggest thing will be noise. But what the fuck are they doing with the helicopters at 2 a.m. flying, if they're flying over residential areas? It doesn't really make any sense unless they're dropping people into people's backyards or something.
Well, he said they'd be doing, you know, was it snatch and grab drills, you know, fly in.
Yeah, and what will they be snatching and grabbing?
A target and then fly out.
Well, is that, you know, again, so are those the people that they're essentially participating and they're saying, hey, we're going to grab these people? Or is that, are they actually going to go and grab some real people, which is what I just mentioned regarding speculation is what they may be, what the speculation of what they might be up to. So are they going to grab some political dissidents in some of these states? Maybe not a lot, but are they going to go in and grab a couple people? Yeah, I mean, it's possible. So
it's fun.
Most of the stuff that they had mentioned, you know, outside of martial law, which seems not to make any sense, I don't think is that far out there. I don't think there's anything wrong with talking about it. I know there's the argument that, well, there's so many stuff that's actually happening that you can tell people about, that you can prove, as opposed to the speculation about this. But I mean, this is something that is actually happening. And I think that knowing about it is a positive thing, that you should know about something like this, because it can affect you and you can, I guess, somewhat prepare for it. I don't know that, you know, you can really
do much, but
it's
your government.
It's not my government. I didn't elect any of these people. I just happen to live in this geographic location that they took over. But I'm saying that, you know, and basically that point was regarding if you're trying to tell people about, you know, freedom and liberty and what the government's doing to counteract that. There's so much stuff that they come out and admittingly say that this is what's happening, you know, would say the police or whatever, as opposed to what people would call quote unquote conspiracy theories, where you have to speculate as to what they're doing. But I think either way, and as I had said through the whole show, that this is disturbing, even if what they're saying that they're doing, they're just doing that. Either way, it's very disturbing. And then there's the speculation as to what the fuck are they doing over these 2 months. But again, even if none of the stuff that we mentioned ends up happening, it's still pretty fucked up what they're doing. And it definitely, I think, prepares them, whether there's the intent or not, to go in and conduct secret operations within the U.S. from special forces.
Yeah, they're hell bent on this, right? You don't put together, and they didn't start planning this operation over Christmas, right? These things take a long time to prepare.
Well, they may have started in Christmas, like 2010 or something.
Yeah. Okay, I stand corrected. Right.
Exactly. You didn't say over last Christmas.
I did not say that in 2014. Right. So, because these things are complicated, they're really complicated. You know, if you do something wrong, you can lose equipment, people, you know, et cetera. It's dangerous.
Shoes.
Yeah, these glasses. Things, you know, let's talk about that. These things are really dangerous. This is heavy equipment. You know, some of these things weigh 10 tons and they're flying over your head. They shouldn't do it there. You know, they're putting people at risk. And my original point at the beginning of the show, I'll make it here in the end. They have spent ungodly amounts of money saying they're going to protect us.
Yeah, and we only got about 4 minutes left, so I guess just close up your point there.
Yeah.
Or whatever you want to, if you want to summarize or any last things you want to say before we go.
It's a clear message that they're never intended to protect us. They intended to do this, surround us with military. There's a reason you don't have your military operating inside your country. There's a lot of examples in history of that, you know. And, you know, one of Alex Jones's famous, you know, quotes about crossing the Rubicon, you know. You weren't allowed to
Crossing the
Rubicon.
The globalists.
We're having fun crossing the Rubicon.
Globalists are going to get us all. It's all the globalists. Don't worry about the local police that kill you and shoot you. Worry about the globalists.
Yeah. So worry about everything. So I, you know, they're just expanding their operations. It's another psyop because they're using special forces. I think they're lying through their teeth about foreign forces, but that's hard to prove. I just have because of his tricolor answer there, I think, you know, they're just leaving the door open for any option they feel they need to.
Always lock your door.
You know what? Post a no trespassing sign on your house.
I was going to do that, actually. I was going to say no.
I'm going to get one myself.
No trespassing, especially government agents. Please leave immediately or something.
No trespassing, no vacancy, you know, no whatever language you're speaking.
Well, and then you go back to the whole thing that it doesn't really matter that to say, well, I had a no trespassing sign, and the police will say, oh, okay, well, you know, we'll just leave, or we will let you sue us now. So, I mean, they're going to do whatever they want anyway, but I still think it's a good idea. I'm going to get one of those. So that's about all the time we have left for tonight. I would really suggest that people look into this and read some of the articles or go to YouTube. I had played 2 of those clips, and I think I posted one of them on the Facebook page. You can go to Facebook and check out the show at facebook.com/nonpartisanlibertyforall and facebook.com/endthegovernmentpolice is our other site. Go to nonpartisanlibertyforall.com to play at least the archives for the past 2 months or listen to the live stream. You can also listen to us at spreaker.com. Tomorrow, as I mentioned, we will have special guest Mark Edge of Free Talk Live, and we will be talking all about jail and how that has become, it seems, the punishment for any crime. And that includes, you know, the suspended sentence there that they say they hang over your head. So be sure to tune in for that. Our voiceover or voice of the show, Katie Reyes, will also be joining us during the show or later on in the show also. So thanks, everybody, for tuning in.
It's necessary. You need to comply with the police officer the way the system was meant to be. Comply with the orders of police officers. Resisting arrest is a real and dangerous crime.